Hello, I hope you are well today. I am sorry for the delay for this video. Been a little busy with school works. Well, this compilation will be the final video from this Isekai Craft manga until we get some new chapters. For those who are here for chapter 7, you can just click to the timestamp. Drop a like and subscribe for more awesome videos. Thank you very much. At night somewhere in the wild, a loud scream echoed. MC got kicked in the back. He fell on the ground and an elf lady stabbed his hand with a blade. With an ominous expression, she tells him not to resist. She then orders to tell her what he, a human, was doing here. MC started talking. His name is Shibata Kosuke, and he liked to play survival games on his computer. But somehow he ended up in a forest, and he couldn't explain how it happened. But the elf girl didn't believe his words. Then he looked at her face and said, "Wow, a dark elf, beautiful." But she gets angry and kicked him hard for that. Not for the word beautiful, but for the word dark elf. She didn't like him calling her that. MC yells at her and called her a savage. She just smiled and sneeringly asked him what he was staring at right now. He was honest and said he was looking at her breasts. She liked his honesty and let him get up. Then she asked him again what he was doing here, and he honestly answered he didn't know, and that was true. When he woke up in this place and looked at the sky, there were two giant planets above him. Then the elven girl tells him they are in Rizu of the Pensa continent, in the Omit wilderness border of the Black Forest. Let's recap MC's first day of survival. He realized he ended up in an unknown place. He had his smartphone and house key, and in his wallet he had two bills and a ticket. He could at least take a taxi and go back home. Well, actually he couldn't. He is in another world, that's tragic. He wished he was in a game, but it was reality. And he needed to think up something. He literally had no idea what to do. Then he calmed down and realized that it would be more important to build a safe shelter first. He luckily ended up in a dark, dense forest. If it was a game, he could just place blocks below to make a stilt shelter. Well, it doesn't matter. He took a stone and quickly made a stone knife, which was his first tool. Then he headed to the forest. Since it was reality, there were a lot of huge insects and bushes. Then MC found a tree that looked nice for his safe shelter. He had to do everything fast while the sun was still out. He got some materials. It wouldn't be possible to survive without a fire, so MC decided to make a bow drill fire starter. It was hard for the first time, but after some attempts he finally ignited a campfire. It was warm, and he started to feel hungry. He was really angry that he didn't have anything in this world. He just ended up here without any special abilities. But MC couldn't go hunting at night. He needed to sleep well now. If it was a game, he could just press the E or F key and summon the craft menu. And once MC thought about it, he suddenly summoned the craft menu. Then he realized he can summon or disable it just by thinking about pressing the E button. It was for real. Then he thought about what would happen by using the tab key. And once he thought about that, he summoned an inventory. From his inventory screen, he could also see his status, and after finding the crafting menu, he realized he was actually in a survival game. What a brilliant luck. He could easily make anything he needed just by using the craft menu. Then he started thinking about what he needed to make right now and how would it work. He took a stone and a stick, and it worked. He could create anything. After some time, he made all the weapons and instruments he needed. Spear and axe wasn't viable for him, and he doesn't have any experience with a bow, so it won't go straight. But it was possible to use at least, and the inventory thing, which is really cool. He could put everything he wanted inside his inventory and not feel its weight, and it was easy to pull out any item from there. Well, now it was time to sleep. Well, it would be dangerous to go somewhere at night time. The hunger was really annoying, but somehow he slept. The next day, MC was fooling around. He imagined he was streaming with a wooden camera, but then he remembered it was reality and all the magic suddenly disappeared. He got really thirsty and thinks about finding a water source. He then realized, if he starts thinking about WSD keys, he could move to any side however he chooses. Well, goodbye laws of inertia. And if he thinks about shift key, he can move faster without getting tired, and he also could bunny jump by using the space key. Bro literally turned into Steve. MC looks forward and saw water. He headed right there. But there was a rock on his way. He tried to do a double jump. He jumped and then used the space key. It worked, then he landed successfully on the ground. But when he looked forward, he saw his first enemy, a lizard. This wasn't good at all. In the next moment, he rushed away from there, and the lizard started chasing him too. MC realized he could use the sprint key, but the lizard was too fast. He decided to take the fight. He took out his spear and threw it into the lizard, but he missed. What bad luck. There was a second one, but the lizard suddenly jumped at him, and he fell on the ground. MC didn't understand what happened, but then he looked at the lizard and realized he defeated him, to make sure that it was dead. He took the stone axe and struck him hard some more times, savage. He opened the window and saw all the loot he could got from the animal's corpse. After he took all the items into his inventory, the lizard's corpse disappeared, although the pool of blood still remained. Well, it was time to go back to his shelter. He crafts a water canteen and puts water into it. He did it 50 times, it might be 50 liters of water. Now he needed to boil this water to sterilize it. When he came back, he saw there was a craft recipe of safe water by using the campfire. He also wanted to grill the meat to make it eatable. MC noticed that the craft icon of the safe water was looking different. It was actually a plastic bottle, and it even increased the water by 5 folds. How could it be possible? Well, he didn't care much and drank his fill. It was really great water, and the meat was also cooked. He took a bite and started crying from happiness. It had the taste of chicken meat. It was his first meal here. After the dinner, he decided to do some more work. First, he needed to create a stone shovel. After that, he started digging around his base. It wasn't hard to do since this world was working like the game. If he digs a little, it digs the entire block. And with the help of inventory, he stored all the dirt as well. Very easy, he finished it quickly. He got some rich soil and clay. Now it was possible to craft some more blocks by using it. There also was a furnace which would be helpful in processing metal. While he was thinking of a way to get iron, it was almost night. He quickly made a hammock on a tree and went to sleep. And when he fell asleep, that elf girl noticed him, and that's how he was suddenly woken up. She listened to his story, and this time she believed him. Then the elf girl summoned some spirits, and they surrounded Kosuke. First he got scared, but when he saw they healed the wound on his hand, he was surprised. It felt really pleasant. She said that the spirit of life actually was fond of him. Kosuke thought he might be able to use magic, but the elf girl broke all his dreams, since she didn't feel any magic aura surrounding him. Then she told him to follow her. He asks, where are they going? She said he was welcome to wait for other hostile creatures or for another elf and be killed on the spot. Hearing this, Kosuke agreed. Then he suddenly realized he still didn't know her name. She turned and realized she had forgotten to say her name. Since there's nobody around here that doesn't know her name, he wondered if she was that famous? She then tells her name is Sylphie. She is one of the guardians of the Black Forest. Humans also know her as the Witch of the Dark Forest. While on the way to her village, Sylphie was too fast for Kosuke. He was breathing hard. She told him to not be so unmanly, as they were almost at the right place. Sylphie pointed forward and Kosuke saw a village. It was pretty large. Kosuke thought that the villagers would be happy to meet him. But Sylphie suddenly gave him a collar and told him to wear it. It looked interesting, but why should he wear it? Sylphie said it will save his life, and she didn't lie. When they came to the village, Kosuke realized it was literally opposite to his dreams. All the beasts wanted to kill him. They were really mad to see a human. Kosuke didn't get what was happening. Sylphie shouted out to everyone to get out of their way. She said she needed to talk with guardians and told Kosuke to wait here. He was worried if he would be safe. Then an elf guy came there and told Kosuke to follow him, and to not gather the attention of the crowd that much. Kosuke didn't mind. They came to a quiet place, then the elf threw him on the ground. Kosuke realized he was betrayed by him. Kosuke looked back and saw two oni that were going to smash him, and other villagers gathered here too. They surrounded Kosuke with weapons. He didn't know what to do. It was such a terrible situation. Then someone shouted out, "What do you think you are doing?" And the cloud of dust covered the sight. When it dissolved, they saw Sylphie. She was holding Kosuke by the collar. He couldn't breathe normally. She told everyone he is her own slave, and no one is able to make him suffer except her. They understood her clearly and walked away. Kosuke realized why she told him to wear this collar, but he actually didn't like that. She kept holding him like a dog. Sylphie said that every dog should be chained with a collar. Kosuke didn't like her jokes. He also wanted to know why those beasts wanted to kill him. Sylphie told him a story. There is a conflict between humans and other races in the kingdom. Subhumans aren't able to live normal life since the king didn't count them as humans. So the refugees from the kingdom live in this village, cause it's way better to live far away from humans. That's why they were that hostile to him. Kosuke looked forward and saw large flying plantations. Sylphie said they grow crops by using magic. It might be even better than in Japan. Sylphie told him to continue following her. and they finally came to Sylphie's place. Kosuke was amazed by how beautiful it was. When Kosuke entered the house, he drew a large breath and it smelled really good. But Sylphie said she didn't burn incense, and it was just always like that. Kosuke wanted to know what was the reason for her capturing him. Sylphie said she did it just for fun, but Kosuke didn't believe her words. Then she said his situation, abilities and knowledge seems interesting to her. And there was also a legend of the god Adir that sometimes summons humans to their world. Sylphie hoped Kosuke was one of those humans, and it meant he could have some interesting powers. She asked him what kind of mysterious power he has. But Kosuke didn't want to show all the aces that fast. But Sylphie really wanted him to answer, and she used all her charisma to force him to talk. Kosuke couldn't keep his silence and started talking. He showed her his inventory and what he can do with it. She was surprised he made all these items by himself. Sylphie wanted to know more about the weapons. Kosuke regretted telling her that much. She also noticed raw lizard meat. He told her how he got it from the lizard after his corpse disappeared, and all the loot came to his inventory. He thought about meat and realized he was hungry. Sylphie told him to make some food as he was her servant, so he should cook for her. Kosuke asked her to help with that, and she didn't mind. It was not bad for his first time cooking a meal. Kosuke would say it was really tasty, but he also needed to sleep somewhere. The floor won't be a good place for that. Sylphie smiled and offered to sleep together in her bed. Kosuke got really shy, but she was persistent. He didn't actually know what to do. This world's social rules may be different from his one. But Sylphie calmed him down. She said all he needs is just a bit of curiosity. Then Kosuke realized there was nothing that would stop him. He gets up and picks Sylphie up. She blushed hard and Kosuke carried her to the bedroom. Sylphie said she was a maiden, and she didn't have any female friend who would tell her such things. Kosuke actually had love experience in his world, but in this world this was Fi's the first time too. She asked him call her by her name Sylphie, and to be gentle. Later they banged. I can't show it here, but the name's in the description, so check it out yourself. By the way, it's chapter 2. The next day Kosuke felt strange, everything was like a blur. He asked Sylphie if she felt good. She answered it was like she lost something important. Kosuke cooked some food and offered it to her, but she was mad at him. Because what he did that to her yesterday were painful, and after a punch to his guts, she told him they were going to gather some material after their breakfast. Both the breakfast and lunch were actually looking great. Later Sylphie chained Kosuke again. He still couldn't get used to it. Everyone was staring at them, but they didn't try to do anything. Were they afraid of Sylphie? Maybe. Then Kosuke noticed that elf guy that tried to kill him yesterday. His name was Nate. Sylphie told Kosuke to not worry about him anyway, he couldn't do anything to him because of her. Kosuke saw some wooden materials and asked Sylphie what they were building. She said it will be the house especially made for refugees. There were a lot of refugees and they needed to live somewhere ever since the Holy Kingdom took over. The refugees lost everything and their only way was to leave the kingdom. Kosuke said everyone who loses the conflict faces fate like this. But he actually understood what she was thinking about. Sylphie might want to help the kingdom of Vernard gain its freedom back. He didn't mind helping her with that since he had a really good skill. He could create any weapon quickly. Well, it was time to hunt, and finally Kosuke could take off the chains since they weren't in the village right now. Sylphie told him to be quiet. He told her to not worry about that and demonstrated how quiet he can be. Looking at it, she got scared of his abilities. It doesn't look normal at all. He also asked her if he could try to cut that tree. Sylphie said it would take too much time to make it useful, but Kosuke wanted to show something. He opened the inventory and took out the stone axe and tapped a few times on the tree. Sylphie thought he was doing something strange, but then the tree suddenly fell down. What the hell was that? She had no words to say. The tree he chopped just now was absolutely clear from all the branches and leaves. Moreover, the tree was looking way straighter than it actually was before. Sylphie thought she was going crazy. Then he reached out his hand and opened the inventory. All the items got immediately sorted there. Kosuke asked Sylphie if he could cut some more trees. She told him to not cut anything but those she will point at. After some time, Kosuke had 50 tree logs. That was enough. Well, now it was time to find some ores. They headed to the mountains. After some time of walking, they suddenly stopped. Kosuke said he heard something strange, but Sylphie told him he was going crazy, and they continued walking. But then she stopped again and there was a huge spider-like beast. Kosuke realized if he met this spider when he was alone, he could be dead already. Sylphie told Kosuke to watch the spider's abdomen. He wanted to say something, but Sylphie was gone. She attacked the spider. She was really fast. Kosuke noticed the spider sting. It was ready to attack. He decided to do something and tried to use the bow like he was in the game. And it worked. The arrow got right into the spider's body. Sylphie didn't lose any time and jumped at the spider. She smashed his head easily. Then she jumped back and landed on the ground successfully. Kosuke was astonished. Sylphie stabbed it again and Kosuke asked if this thing was edible. She said it's absolutely not, but its poison gland and abdomen is worth a bit. Then she added he can actually use the spider's legs. Its meat might be good for the bow. Sylphie told Kosuke to use his inventory and bring the beast to the village. Then he came closer and reached his hand out. The spider's corpse suddenly disappeared. He looked into his inventory. This beast was called a gizma. Sylphie was very surprised to know this beast was walking in the forest since it must live in Omit Wilds. She realized that the bad things she was thinking about were becoming real. She told Kosuke that a lot of refugees were killed by these monsters. That was terrible. She said that they didn't see any new refugees for the last 2 years. It meant these monsters were just killing them. Sylphie told Kosuke to go back since they might meet more gizmas or other dangerous beasts. He realized he could have easily met them while he had been gathering the stones when he was alone, and if a gizma attacked him, then he would have been dead right there. It seemed that he got really lucky. In the next panel, Kosuke found a lot of resources in the pond, but the temperature was cold. But never mind, Kosuke was determined to make a workbench today. Luckily, he got a lot of magnetic sand, and it was time to create a simple furnace. After that, Kosuke needed to create the materials for creating a workbench. It was just like in the game, but still a bit hard. He needed wood nails, vise, and toolbox for creating a workbench. Much harder than a game where we just need 4 wooden planks. The vise, he needed 20 pieces of steel and 10 mechanical parts. The easiest thing was that he didn't even need to know how to make it. He just needed the materials, and that's all. He was wondering where Sylphie was right now. She said she went to watch the perimeter, but she still hadn't come back. Well, he finally made the vise. It was the last material he needed for creating the workbench. Nice, it was way easier and faster than he thought. He immediately puts it down, and it looks similar to that of the game. He opened the menu and was really surprised by how much stuff he was able to create now, and there were also new types of weapons. A crossbow, for example. He looked at the makeshift crossbow recipe. He needed 2 twigs, 2 wooden sticks, mechanical details, and 20 fibers. But he could actually make a better version of it, but he needed to craft a steel plate spring first. But how to make it? He opened the recipe, and there appeared more windows to create the spring. He needed to upgrade his furnace, and he needed to upgrade his workbench. That was too hard to do right now. Then Kosuke noticed a new section there. He opened it, and saw his level and stats. Not bad there, you can see all the stats Kosuke can upgrade. Well, he couldn't decide what to upgrade first, so he decided to do it later. There also was an achievements menu. There were a lot of locked achievements, but some of them were already completed. First workbench, after completing this achievement, he was allowed to see his status, skills, and achievements in the menu. So every achievement was giving him something. Then he saw he completed the achievement first mate, just because he had an act of love with Sylphie. What the hell, and it actually wasn't his first time, but was there something else, an achievement technician, because he made Sylphie feel great that night? Kosuke didn't notice Sylphie came back and got scared. He apologized for letting his guard down. She also came here with the rabbit. She told him to use his inventory. Sylphie praised him for his work. She was surprised to see the shovel made of steel. There also was a steel pickaxe. Kosuke struck the stone a few times and it disappeared. He gave her a little piece of iron ore from his inventory. He didn't know why it was working in that strange way, but if it works, then it doesn't matter. She asked him if that wasn't a magic tool or something, and Kosuke tells her that it wasn't nothing special. It happens whenever he used some kind of tool. What he said was true, because after using the tool herself, nothing much happened. Sylphie told she will protect him from danger. He felt awkward because of her words. Then Kosuke put a sandwich on the table. It was still warm, and Sylphie was wondering if the time in the inventory just stops. His power ignores this world's logic. Sylphie told Kosuke they needed to go back to the village today. There was something she wanted to talk about with the elders. Hold it. The elf guard was yelling at Sylphie. He didn't want to let her and the human meet the elders. But she just ignored him and marched forward. Then the guard stops her by putting his hand on her shoulder and was going to say something. But in the next moment, he immediately got a strike in the face, and that's what happens to those who make Sylphie angry. They entered the house. There was a big hall room in the center of the room where the elders were sitting. They were surprised to see Sylphie since she didn't like their company at all. Sylphie said she came here to submit today's report. They immediately asked about Kosuke. He was human, so it was obvious that they were interested in him. The elder said she didn't feel any magic around him. Is he perhaps a Marabito, a guy from another world? And she guessed right. Well, it wasn't the main thing Sylphie wanted to talk about. She said that gizmos have appeared in the dark forest. It was a serious problem. The elders started talking with each other about that. All the problems were because of refugees, and the elves actually had no reasons to help them. Then the elder asked Sylphie about Kosuke. Didn't she want to make him her own servant? And moreover, they knew she already had mingled with him on the first night. Sylphie blushed hard. How did they figure that out? Well, the elder elf said that her magic aura just changed a bit. It happens to every woman who accepts a man. Finally, the time has come for the tumbling Sylphie-chan, and hearing this, she was going to sink into the floor. The elder said she was the only royal bloodline virgin girl. That information surprised Kosuke. Well, it wasn't time for jokes. The elder elf asked Sylphie seriously, who is this man? Sylphie answered that she didn't know anything about him, but that he appeared from nowhere in the forest, and that he has some interesting skills. The elder elf didn't feel like she could trust her words. She was going to take Kosuke into their custody. But Sylphie refused to let them do that and hugged him hard, and it seemed that he didn't mind at all. Bro is really lucky. Well, the elder elf realized they are looking good together, so she decided to watch what would happen next. But despite being a Marabito, he was also a human. It meant it would be hard for villagers to accept him. Kosuke needed to show them his best, and then the villagers would accept him. Sylphie understood the elder elf's words. They wanted to see his powers and work, so everything was on him. Then Sylphie told Kosuke it was time to go, and as they were going to leave, the elder elf asked Kosuke for his name. He told her his name, and the elder elf asked him to take care of Sylphie. "We'll do as long as I can," and they left the house. In front of their house, Kosuke asked Sylphie if she was okay. She looked a bit nervous, and Kosuke just wanted to lighten the mood. She said she was just thinking about what they need to do now. Sylphie said that if they will be able to save the refugees with Kosuka's powers, then he will be accepted by the villagers. Kosuke asked if they needed some help with building the walls. Sylphie said at their pace it'll be completed in 6 months. He thinks about it, and he said he can help with that. First, he started making the items he needed. He also needed to create some bricks. Kosuke didn't show all his powers to Sylphie, so it was time to demonstrate something. He swung his arms and there appeared a block of wood, and then he started walking back and placing the blocks like he was in a game. He just built the wall in a few seconds. Sylphie was speechless. What the hell? Kosuke really surprised Sylphie by his trick. And with a smug smile, he said if we do it this way, making a wall's going to be a piece of cake. Previously, the elders and Danon's group found out about the princess getting clapped by Kosuke. No one expected to hear that from Sylphie, and even Kosuke was confused. No one could believe her words. As Kosuke is a human, this act was scandalous. "Calm down this instant," Sylphie shouted out to everyone. She was going to explain everything. She told them he came from another world, and after seeing his strange abilities, she can testify for him. But Danon and others still felt confused and didn't trust Kosuke, as they didn't sense any magic from him, and it was obvious that he was a normal human. They start to make fun of Kosuke, calling his stench unbearable, which he think was pretty harsh. Sylphie knew they wouldn't believe it until they had seen it with their own eyes. She tells them to exchange words with Kosuke first before doubting her judgment. Then Sylphie told Kosuke to tell them everything about himself. It was really important, and he told them his story. It was hard to believe, but somehow they believed his words. Danon told Kosuke, if Her Highness believes in him, he will too. But if Kosuke will harm Her Majesty, then he will stab Kosuke's heart with his own horns. Kosuke understood him clearly. Danon then introduced himself first. He was a Marinard Imperial Guard, and served as the Vice Commander of the Knights. Then the sheep girl introduced herself. Her name is Melty. She was the Internal Affairs Minister for the Marinard Kingdom. Kosuke was surprised to see a sheep girl there. He liked her from the first glance of her bedonkers, and of course she noticed him staring. Then the Cyclops girl introduced herself as Era. She was the Marinard Kingdom's court mage, and when Kosuke looked into her eye, she tried to hide it. Well, she was a shy girl. The wolf was next. His name was Kyubi. He had no status or special abilities like the others, but he was pretty confident in himself. The leaders and Kosuke finally found a common ground. Now it was time to talk about more important things. Melty then asked him to clarify about his abilities and what kind of things he can make. So Sylphie offered them to go outside and see everything with their own eyes. Then a refugee entered the tent and reported that they were having problems with the food. The leaders then told Sylphie to let them handle this and to continue ahead what they wanted to do. Then Sylphie told them to not wait for them, as they still had a lot of things to do. They came to the empty place where Kosuke had already placed some bricks. Sylphie grinned and told them to just watch the show, and the spectators stood there waiting. Kosuke first asked if he could break the brick wall, and Sylphie didn't mind. Then he took out his pickaxe, and after the first tap the block of bricks just disappeared. The spectators just stood there in shock with their eyes and mouth wide open. He then started swinging the pickaxe, and the brick wall just started disappearing from the touch. Sometimes later, when the territory was cleared from the bricks, now it was time to build the wall. The spectators were in shock but ready to see what would happen next. Then Kosuke started walking back and swinging his hands, and the bricks were appearing from nowhere. The people in attendance were in shock, and seeing this, Sylphie chuckled. After the wall was built, Kosuke told them to touch this wall to check if it's not an illusion or something else. Then Kyubi and Danin came closer and started hitting it, but it was too hard to break. Impossible. He built the wall just in a few seconds, which would take us 2 weeks. Eira couldn't believe he was just doing this with no cost. This was illogical. What trick did you use? Eira asked Kosuke. She didn't want to believe her own eyes. Kosuke said he didn't know about his abilities, it was just working and that's all. But Eira wanted to know more. Sylphie told Kosuke to explain everything to her or she won't calm down. So Kosuke showed her his other abilities. She couldn't believe it was working like that, but she was holding a plastic bottle right now whose quantity was different from the used wooden canteen. Are you tinkering with it in your inventory? Eira asked Kosuke. He told her everything he could, but it was still impossible to explain why it was working in that way. But Melty was happy to know that Kosuke had such powers which could increase the materials. She asked Kosuke, could he also make food with his craft ability? Which he didn't know because he never tried. Then Melty and Eira caught Kosuke. They were going to test if he can multiply the food like how he did with water, and Eira was going to conduct some other tests with him. It seemed that Kosuke and others were getting along, that was nice. After an hour Kosuke felt really tired, they forced him to work hard. Kyubi asks him about Melty, and he told her that she made him work like a machine to grind flour on the millstone for an hour. And thanks to that he found out that by using things by hands drastically cuts down crafting time. Kyubi then passed him his lunch, Gizma's meat. It had a similar taste of chewy garlic shrimp. It was his first time eating an insect. And his country people weren't eating such strange food, in fact they even had no monsters. Eira was shocked, how could it be possible? Monsters should be everywhere where mana is. And she was surprised even more when Kosuke told her that his world has no mana. She couldn't believe that, because mana is essential for life. Kosuke tells her that he is sitting her in flesh, so how can that be? And Eira tells him that his existence is illogical. What a strange guy. But she liked him. Sylphie came there and told Kosuke, he was spending a lot of time with Eira today. He tells her that they were teaming up to support her, so of course he would try to get along. Kosuke then notices that she was getting jealous, which looked very cute. He lunges at her and told her that he will remain faithful to her, and since he said it too loudly, he got a punch in the stomach, knocking him on his knees. She tells him not to hump in broad daylight, and Kyubi calls him a friendly little one. Then she asks Sylphie what's the course of action now? Sylphie said it was time to continue building the wall. Sylphie has already ordered Danin to gather clay. And the only other thing they now need is fuel, so there shouldn't be any problem. However, Kyubi tells her that they currently had no kindling at the moment. Then Sylphie smiled and told them that Kosuke will solve this problem easily. The first tree fell on the ground and Kyubi and Eira were again shocked by Kosuka's ability. He only put enough force to make a notch, but the tree toppled. Besides, the wood was straight log and dry enough to make a plank. It was way more absurd than that trick with water, and Kyubi tells him with this he can surely make a lot of money. Eira then said that Melty will be mad with joy if he showed her this ability, and Kyubi tells him Melty would probably have him cutting the trees forever. But Kosuke thinks that she wouldn't go that far, right? But they didn't answer and just turned their back. Kosuke worried asked them to keep this a secret from Melty, which they somewhat agreed on. Then Sylphie told Eira and Kyubi to go get some clay. But Eira asked Sylphie to let her watch Kosuke for some more time. She didn't mind and let her stand with them. Kyubi immediately started carrying the order and ran towards the forest. He jumped high enough to cross a couple of trees. Kosuke admired his physical strength. Well, Sylphie was going to mark all the trees they needed to be cut, and Kosuke was ready for it. Sun was setting and they started to wrap things up. They did a lot of work today. Era realized that Kosuka's instruments and items had no magic powers, but it starts working in that crazy way only when Kosuke uses it. It was illogical enough to break her brain. While Era was holding the axe, she thinks that maybe she would have to dissect him. Hearing this, Kosuke was scared by her, but she actually wasn't going to cut him in parts. Well, at least while he is alive. That sounded creepy. Later at night, Kosuke and Sylphie were returning home. He felt really tired, so Sylphie praised him for his work today. Then she asked him what was he holding. He tells her it was bread. The people who gave it to me to give to you put in some extra for me. He was glad to know he started getting along with the refugees. Sylphie was glad to hear that too. She also praised him for the work he did over that millstone. He still couldn't forget that hell, so he asked Sylphie to not remind him about that. Sylphie asked Kosuke, "What do you think? Can you get along with the crew?" Well, he wasn't sure, but everything was looking good. Melby has seen enough to know his usefulness. As for Era, she'll be cool as long as her interest in his ability doesn't waver. He was unsure about Kyuvi, but he seems pretty good nature at glance. And it seemed that the only problem might be Dan, and he would be the most difficult person of them all. But Kosuke felt like he could get along with him too. Kosuke then tells her he has done some thinking about whether everyone should get a crossbow or not. He said it won't end well if someone with bad intentions got their hands on this weapon. It might end badly. Sophie asks if he still doesn't feel trusting of others. He then tells her that on his arrival he was ganged up on and threatened with torture and death, so can she blame him? Well, Kosuke was ready to produce the crossbow and offered her to decide who gets one. Sophie said it's a good idea. They then came to Kosuka's workshop. It finally was the time to prepare everything for tomorrow. He placed some furnaces and put all the materials there. Everything was working by itself. Kosuke was happy to have such handy powers. He then notices that he got some materials for upgrade. Then he asks Sylphie if he can use a few materials for an upgrade. She asks what's an upgrade, and he tells her it's for improving efficiency and capabilities of his production. Then Kosuke clicked on the upgrade icon. The bright light suddenly filled the room. When it dissolved, they saw an upgraded furnace with an anvil and sharpening stone. Bro, now it's cheating. He actually got an anvil with a blast furnace. Well, it actually broke his wall. For some reason, it seems that the new furnace needed a bit more space. Now it was time to see what this new furnace can do. Kosuke noticed that now he could upgrade the crossbow and the workbench. Moreover, he could start creating better armor and weapons. Sylphie requested Kosuke to make a long-handled weapon for Danin. There were some variants he could create, like a halberd or a battle axe, but that doesn't quite fit from what he was imagining. And then he finally got an idea: a bardish. This would suit the gigantic body of Danin. Suddenly the weapon appeared in the crafting menu when Kosuke thought about it. Another interesting thing about his powers. Moreover, he also could repair things like armor or weapons. Sylphie instantly got an idea. She told Kosuke to follow her. They came to the little warehouse. There were the spoils of war. It was looking pretty old, and it seemed that this blood couldn't be removed. Kosuke opened his inventory. He was going to transport it all inside his inventory. There everything was all right until Kosuke noticed some items were cursed. It scared him a bit. Wasn't it dangerous to hold cursed items? Sylphie said there's a way to remove the curse by melting the weapon. They came back to Kosuka's workshop. He was going to repair all the equipment. Until he saw a warning, "You will be cursed." He was still worrying about that. But then Kosuke realized that the weapon for Danin was already done. It was bardish, a kind of battle axe which is huge and heavy. He gave it to Sylphie. Even for her, it was a bit hard to move with. He told Sylphie there's a blade that would fit her very well. Sylphie came closer to him and asked to make it especially for her. He was glad to help her, but he didn't understand her hint. Then she straightly offered him to get some fun in bed. Tonight Kosuke was glad to accept her wish, and he said, "I almost forgot how you need to be satisfied every night," and these words changed the situation, but not in Kosuka's favor. That night was pretty rough for Kosuke, so I would suggest my cultured viewers to read it in the manga. It's chapter 8, have fun! The next day Kosuke felt tired. He kind of resembled a dried fish. But Sylphie was glistening. She was excited for the new day of work, and Kosuke followed her with dead enthusiasm. They reached to the village square. There they saw a huge heap of clay. Sylphie told Kosuke to bring out all the weapons they repaired yesterday. Swords and shields dropped on the ground from his inventory. Then Sylphie ordered Dana to distribute these weapons to those who can fight. Then she told Kosuke to bring out the weapon made for Danon. Sylphie gave him his bardish. When Danon took it, he immediately realized it fits great for him. This could cut through Gizma like knife through butter. Danon was wondering if it was made by Kosuka's powers. Sylphie said it's true, and she smiled since Danon still didn't know about Kosuka's other abilities. Then Kosuke told everyone to clear a path. He was going to build up the smelting utilities here. He swung his hands, and in the next moment there appeared a furnace with the anvil and the sharpening stone. After that he placed more simple furnaces like it's just a wall. Everyone felt shocked. Era was staring at him with jealousy. She came closer to see how it worked. She still couldn't believe how it was working. It's illogical. So Kyubi picked her up and took her behind. While the furnaces were working, Kosuke decided to repair some busted swords and told Sylphie to bring them all in a one big batch. He also needed to collect all this clay. Kosuke took his shovel and started working. Era was watching him closely. She still wanted to figure out how it works. It isn't magic, but then what is it then? Kosuke looked to the side and saw Melty. She was looking at Kosuke with a friendly grin. His sight fell on the grindstone she brought here. Well, he tried to ignore it this time. He didn't want to do the same work he did yesterday. Then Kosuke finished collecting the clay he needed to create blocks of bricks. He swung his hands and there appeared a workbench. He was going to create an upgraded workbench. Era came closer and focused all her attention to see what would happen next. Kosuke warned her it might be a bit bright, but she wanted to see everything. Then Kosuke pressed the button, and the bright light blinded them all. Melty asked what that was. Kosuke explained to her it was a process of upgrading. In the end, he got an upgraded version of the workbench. It was made of iron, which looked more sturdy. Then Era said she saw something. It was a glimpse of the truth. It reminded her of the holy magic used by priests. They got silent. Then Kosuke played along with her by saying it's true. Well, it was a joke. He told her he came from another world, so it implies the existence of some entity with great power. There was silence. Era believed his words. She stayed in the same pose, holding her head until lunchtime came. Today they had some burgers for lunch, which looked tasty. Sylphie asked Kosuke if he was going to continue building the wall later today. He said that they made enough brick blocks, so it would be nice to finish the job. Era addressed Sylphie. She told her that she got an idea how to prove the fact that Kosuke came here from another world. It was interesting. Era pointed at his slave collar, and they stared at it. She told them if Kosuke removed the collar by himself, it would prove him as a Marabito. Everyone got her idea, then started thinking. Kyubi tells everyone, if Kosuke tries to remove the collar himself, then it will strangle him to death. It scared Kosuke. So he started yelling at them to explain everything to him. Era said the slave collar immobilizes the wearer via their own mana and strangles them. But since Kosuke had zero magic powers, it meant this collar wouldn't work at all. It was kind of interesting. Then Kyub asked Sylphie to test it out. Sylphie then ordered him to take off all his clothes, but he denied her request, but agreed to strip if she insists. Bro MC is definitely a masochist. Then Melty asked him if he would be able to take the collar off by himself. Then Kosuke put his hands on the collar, and suddenly realizes that during their bed games Sylphie was thinking she could command him all this time, then it meant there was. But Kosuke immediately got hit in the face for these thoughts. Melty asked Kosuke how much time building the wall might take. He said with enough blocks it might take around 2 or 3 hours. Then Sylphie got up and said that right after Kosuke is done with the wall they will hold a demonstration. Kosuke headed to the furnaces to take the bricks. Then Danon addressed him. He wanted to know why Kosuke didn't do anything bad to the princess if the collar wasn't working all this time. Kosuke just said there were no reasons to do that. Moreover, she saved his life. His words surprised Danon, but he believed him because Kosuke was an honest person. Kosuke asked Sylphie that he wanted to check out the area and wanted someone who knows his way around the area. Danon took a step towards and told everyone he will accompany Kosuke. Sylphie just smiled cause Dana was glad to accompany him. They headed to the village entrance. Sylphie, Melty, Era and Kyubi were glad to see that Danon and Kosuke finally got along. After some time Kosuke finished the wall. The last thing was to set up the gates and all done. He finished building the wall around the village. Danon was very surprised that Kosuke did all his work that quickly. He did a great job. But Kosuke had doubts about the height of the wall. He thought gizmos can just jump like the insects in his world. Danin just calmed him down. Gizmo can't jump that high, their legs are used to jump straight forward for ramming attacks. He also added that gizmos usually gather into groups and attack from an ambush. Sylphie was waiting for them. Danin and Kosuke finally finished the job. A large crowd gathered near the wall to listen to what Sylphie wanted to say, and some elf villagers were here too. There was silence, then Sylphie started her speech. They finished building the wall with their help very quickly. The completed wall is thick and sturdy, so even if the gizmo attacks, they don't have to worry. And it's all thanks to Kosuke, a human that came here from another world. Sylphie said that Kosuke has no mana at all. Even the insects in this world have a little amount of mana, but Kosuke had literally zero. Aira, who was an imperial mage, has also confirmed it. But Sylphie also wanted to show them the real proof, so she pointed at Kosuka's collar. It was a slave collar, so if he has mana, then he won't be able to remove it without the master's command. But Kosuke just put his hands on the collar, and to everyone's surprise, he easily took it off. No way. But it was true. She might stop at that moment, but to convince everyone and to prove the fact this collar wasn't fake, she offered them to test it out. A few brave monsters took a step forward. First was the cat girl. Sylphie put the collar on her neck. In order to kneel, the cat girl couldn't fight back the order. Then the lizard put the collar on Lamia girl. When she tried to take it off, she started suffocating hard, so the collar wasn't fake. Now it was time to test it out on Kosuke again, and they were glad to do that. The cat girl put the collar on him and gave him an order to kneel, but Kosuke just refused. She tried a few more times, but it wasn't working at all. And then he just took it off his neck without any effort, telling them he just have one mistress, who is Sylphie. Then Sylphie hugged him. It seems that she was the only person he obeyed. When everyone saw it with their own eyes, Sylphie said what they wanted to hear. Yes, Kosuke is a human, but he came from another world with only good intentions. After her words, there was just silence, but Melty started applauding, which led the monsters to applaud too. Kosuke was a bit scared, the monsters' gaze were very intense. Sylphie was glad to know everyone agreed with her, then she ended her speech. Seeing this, Kosuke realized they still had a lot of work to do. Later, Sylphie and others gathered to discuss their next plan. They needed to make a plan against the gizmos. Here Kosuke noticed some new faces. The cat girl introduced herself as Jajira. She was previously a scout in the royal army. Pilna, the harpy, was also from the same squad. The werdog named Ward was the captain of the guards in Tanto City. There also was a bear girl named Gerda. She was from the heavy infantry of the Marinard Royal Army. Kosuke was surprised that there were so many women who were soldiers. Well, in this world, male and female beast men have the same strength. Then Sylphie told Kosuke to show them the weapons. And Kosuke puts a bunch of crossbows on the table. Everyone got interested in what that was. They never saw such an interesting weapon like this. Sylphie told Kosuke to show how it works. He took a step forward and put the steel chest plate on the ground. He showed them how to load the crossbow. It wasn't that hard. Then when everything was prepared, he aimed and shot the arrow. It pierced the chest plate very easily, and with a little training, anyone can learn to hit their mark to some extent. Everyone was surprised to see how easily it worked. Kosuke offered everyone to try it out. Jajira was the most excited among them. She loaded the crossbow. Damn, that bunda. After using it, she immediately realized this weapon fits her great. Aira too was interested in the mechanism of this weapon. This weapon might be really hard to make without Kosuka's powers, but they can try to look at this mechanism better and try to create something like that by themselves. Gerda couldn't use the crossbow since she was too big for this small weapon. Ward was fine with it. Then Jajira asked about the range of this weapon. Kosuke said it's pretty much goes around 50 meters. Danin asked Sylphie how many crossbows could Kosuke create? Kosuke answered that he could make around 300 with just the materials on hand. However, they also needed to create arrows. That's a problem since they didn't have that much resources. Sylphie said it's okay and asked Kosuke to make some weapons for reserve, about 300 crossbows and 5,000 arrows. Since they needed more iron, Sylphie said they also need to get more resources tomorrow. At the moment, Kosuke put out 202 arrows. Then Jajira told Danin she was going to try it out and hoop the wall to test the crossbow. Now Danin hoped she wouldn't do anything bad with this weapon. While he also wanted to take the crossbow and took 100 arrows with him, he also left Melty in charge of the rest. Sylphie said they don't need to worry if there aren't enough weapons or materials, since Kosuke can make everything. Well, she shouldn't say such things when Melty is standing nearby. She already has some dirty thoughts that was a mistake. Sylphie said they were going to visit the elders. Kosuke did his part of the job, so she wanted to hear what they would say. It was evening. The elder elf was glad the wall was done in a day, but she was still doubtful if the humans won't attack them. Well, they were too old to think normally. So Sylphie was getting annoyed by their behavior. Anyway, they were going to keep the promise, the elder elf said. They will send them 20 spirit archers to intercept the gizma. Sylphie was engrossed in the thought. Kosuke asked Sylphie if 20 of these spirit archers were sufficient. Sylphie explained to him that they're the warriors who can use the spirit magic to shoot their arrow, which gets twice more speed, and the arrows are loaded with destructive energy which blows on impact. Kosuke was amazed by the magic of this world. The elder elf said they better make good use of them. Sylphie thanks her and prepares to leave. The elder elf knew she wanted to spend some time together with Kosuke, so she didn't want to hold them up. Hearing this, Sylphie blushed hard from embarrassment. They also started talking about their future children, which was absolutely embarrassing for Sylphie to hear. She couldn't listen to them anymore and just took Kosuke and rushed away from there, and the group of elders just sat. Sylphie was very mad, and it's the behavior like this why she hates being with the elders. Then suddenly they saw their old friend Nate. He wanted to stop them again by calling her impure one. Sylphie wasn't in the mood to talk with him, so she landed a powerful punch right between his eyes, making a great impact. The hit was really good. After she punched him, she felt better. Kosuke asked why this guy was always that hostile to her. Sylphie answered it was because he wanted to take revenge on her for his parents' death. There was a story. It happened 3 years ago. A rebellion occurred in the Mariner Kingdom. Sylphie sneakily entered their common warehouse and stole all the spirit stones. Of course, she was chased by the guards. However, Danon's refugee squad met the Holy Kingdom's army. Of course, it was going to end really badly for them, since the refugees had literally no chances against them. Sylphie couldn't just watch this terrible massacre. The anger took over her mind and she attacked the Holy Kingdom's army. In the end, her skin color had been changed to dark and her muscles had got stronger. Yes, when the elf's anger and hatred continue, they gets entwined with the darkness and becomes the death machine. The elves whose skin color was changed to dark were called tainted, and this is the reason Nate hates her that much. But Kosuke also wanted to know about what happened to Nate's parents. Sylphie said they and a lot of other elves died that day because she lost her mind. The elves' guards, including Nate's parents, entered the fight against the Holy Kingdom's army, and they died. Her once fair skin and slender body is hardly recognizable now. Kosuke listened to her story and just smiled. He told her she shouldn't care too much about her past. Moreover, he loved her as she is. Sylphie smiled. She was thankful to Kosuka's kindness. She got closer and they looked into each other's eyes. They were holding their hands tight. Tonight their relationship got even stronger than it was. On the seventh day of survival, Kosuke almost finished upgrading the crossbow and a few more things, and he was finally done with the improved crossbow. While Kosuke couldn't use it normally since it was way harder than the usual crossbow, then he realized he needed to just think about this like he is in the game, and it worked. Without this cheat ability, he wouldn't be able to do that. He tried to do a test shot. As expected, it was way stronger than the usual crossbow, but it seemed that this weapon would be possible to use only by someone strong. Now Kosuke needed to use the forge. He noticed that he could craft some glassware and other stuff. It seems that it might be used for making potions, so he decided to keep aside some materials for the brewing stand. Now while the forge was working, Kosuke opened his achievements window, and there were some new achievements that he got, but it would be hard to say what these achievements gave him as a reward. There were also some more skills he could unlock, like woodsman and dismantler. He also used some points into strong circulation, fast runner, and marksman skill. Then Sylphie entered the room in a daze. Kosuke said morning to her, but she was but naked, so immediately blushed red. She couldn't take it, so she ran away. Kosuke finds her reaction very cute. He was also wondering whether due to the amount of things she deals during day, but when she gets in the mood for it at night, she really end up going at it. But then by the morning she puts on a straight face, only to realize and feel the shame she had to bear. Which is really fantastic. Kosuke really liked her personality. The breakfast was ready. Sylphie made an angry face and told Kosuke to not remind her about their last night, which he just agreed. She asked him if he was done with mass producing the crossbows, which he was. So today they will proceed with gathering more iron ores. With a group of recon, they headed to the canyon, which was a good place for mining. Sylphie told them to hunt down any monster which they spot. With Kosuke's inventory, he can bring back whatever they end up hunting. Jijaira was very excited to test out the new version of crossbow. After getting her orders, she took it and rushed to hunt immediately. Kosuke was wondering why Jijaira was so excited for the crossbow. Pilma told him, Jijaira was never able to use a simple bow, but with a crossbow she can actually manage to hit stuff with it and be helpful. Pilma also asked Kosuke if he had something as cool as crossbow which she could use. Well, Kosuke had no idea what he could do now, sadly. He did have something in mind, but he can't make it right now, disappointed. Pilma goes into the air to scout the area ahead and quickly flew away. Now it was time to mine and mine hard. Kosuke asked Sylphie whether he should mine from top to bottom, but how was he planning to get up there? Kosuke told her not worry, he had an idea. He started to jump and place blocks under himself. Much to the shock of Aira and Sylphie, bro is literally towering in real life. In the next moment, he ended up at the top of the canyon. Then he put one more block to safely step on the ground. He took out his pickaxe from the inventory and just started digging blocks. Like in a certain crafting game, stone blocks were disappearing one by one. Sylphie and Aira were just staring at this crazy sight. Looking at the results, Sylphie was going to lose her mind, and Aira's brain simply refuses to comprehend this. Sylphie asked him, using this method, could he make the walls as high as he want? Kosuke thinks he can, but there were better and more effective alternatives to the wall. Then Aira went to collect some special herbs. Her alchemy and medicines were vital for treating the refugees' injuries and illnesses. Kosuke continued working hard, and after some time he dug the entire canyon and turned it into a large quarry. He had collected a lot of iron ore and even some mithril ore. When they heard the word mithril, both of them were shocked. Aira asked Kosuke showed her this thing. It was mithril for sure, and a pure one at that. Sylphie told him not to speak about this to anyone, and he thought, was it really that big of a deal? Well, hearing this, it would be better to hide this material in the inventory. However, Aira wasn't ready to part ways with this little piece of mithril. It seemed that she wanted it very badly. Kosuke looked at Sylphie, and after a nod, he gave it to Aira as a present. She was very happy. An alchemist like Aira surely would have plenty of uses for it. Then Pilna and Jijaira came back and were shocked when they saw the change of terrain, and they got even more surprised after they realized it was done with only Kosuka's powers. Later they came back to the village. Sylphie asked Melty, was there anything new to report? Well, there was news from scouts that gizmas were spotted on the outskirts of the forest. Sylphie suggested that they needed to organize a unit with the light-footed personnel. Dana was thinking the same way. Meanwhile, Kosuke was doing something interesting. Aira asked him about this strange thing he was using now. Kosuke told her it's a brewing stand. He could make some potions with it. Kosuke was going to create some by using the herbs Aira had collected. Then he opened the craft window to see what kind of things he can craft. He was surprised. He saw a recipe of gunpowder, and there were two ways to craft it. The first recipe included sulfur, which would make a black powder, but what was the other recipe? There were multiple kinds of gunpowder, and it wasn't comforting that they're all listed as just gunpowder. He had nothing to say but absurd. He just left it at that and crafted whatever he could. After some time, he made a lot of potions. Aira asked him what are the various medicines he had crafted. He tells her that red one's a life potion, green one's a cure potion, the gold one's a cure potion, and the purple one's a poison potion. Aira wanted to know the way it can be used. Kosuke explained to her that he has no idea, but maybe all you need is just to drink it all up and it would work. Aira looked at him suspiciously. And after his explanation, she couldn't believe whether if all these potions weren't fake. With a serious look in her eyes, she ordered Kosuke to hand over all the potions he made. Scared by her, he gave her everything he had. Kosuke felt a shiver from looking at her eyes. When you stare into the abyss stares back at you. At this moment, those were the only words that could come into his mind. Later, it was the training time. Danan taught them how to use a crossbow, and everyone seems quite interested to learn. Kosuke was chilling under the tree. Sylphie came there and asked what he was doing. Kosuke looks at her while he was using the loom. He told her, weaving loom, I guess? She asked him, what was he doing exactly? Kosuke was working on his loom to make some clothes. You can never have too much clothes on hand, and it can be used to craft bandages, which are very useful. Then looking at Kosuke, Sylphie realized he does need some new clothes for his use. Kosuke smiled and thanked her for noticing. Then they headed to the shared warehouse to look for some clothes. The elf gladly welcomed them, and of course Kosuke had a present for these guys. They let them enter the warehouse, and when they entered, they met a beautiful elf woman. Her name is Lisa. Sylphie said they need some clothes for Kosuke, and if there's anything he want, he can ask her for everything. Then Kosuke used this opportunity and asked her for some leather, glue, and alcohol. She was a bit surprised by a strange word, alcohol, and he explained that it's something which resembles liquor. She then led them inside the giant warehouse. There Kosuke collected the materials he needed and got some clothes with the help of Sylphie. He wore the clothes and asked how he looked. Kosuke thought it was quite plain, but it's comfortable. Both the girls stared at him. Lisa thought it didn't look good enough because of his black hair, and Sylphie thought it's fine, he already went through the trouble of dyeing it. Then she showed him how to wear it right. Looking at his clothes, he thought it's okay as long as it was comfortable. When Sylphie and Kosuke came back, they saw Aira. She was looking pretty tired and upset for some reason. Then she told them she tested out all the potions, and the results were strange. These potions had no side effects, at least now, and these were working instantly, so it was hard to evaluate such absurd potions normally. Kosuke was puzzled. Then Aira told him he said that these potions were meant for healing wounds, removing poisons, and curing illnesses. But he need to realize that a medicine is matter of life and death. It would be irresponsible for him to carelessly hand them out. Is that so? Hearing this, her face changed in sadness. Aira couldn't hold back anymore. She started crying and realized she was mistaken and apologized for everything she said. Kosuke couldn't understand what was happening. Sylphie tells him to go to the work area for a bit and leave Aira to her. Kosuke had a lot of thoughts about Aira. She was a very nice girl. Of course, as every court maid, she is petite and has a specific personality, but what could make her feel bad? He couldn't get it. Then Sylphie asked Kosuke to come here. It seemed that they needed to have a serious talk. Aira told him that she was jealous of his abilities. He understood everything. She was working hard to get at least something useful, and then there appears a guy that can create such a miracle stuff without putting any effort in it. So it was an obvious reaction. But Aira was apologizing to her because she realized he didn't get these powers without any sacrifice. He gave up everything he had and ended up here. Kosuke said he wasn't angry at her at all, so there were no problems. But he noticed that Sylphie and Melody were a bit sad too. Sylphie said, after hearing Aira, it got her thinking. He only got his power after coming to this world as Marabito. In other words, this power came at the cost of his family, friends, home, and everything else that he had. But Kosuke actually hadn't thought too much about that. He was just okay with his new life in another world. Moreover, he have no idea whether he can return to his previous world or not. Sylphie tells him even though he was in such a situation, they have been using him for their own purpose. But Kosuke was still thankful to Sylphie for saving his life that day, and he still haven't completely paid that debt back yet. Plus, he is still in the middle of learning his power. And he was thankful to them because he can try them out in a safe environment where he doesn't need to worry about food and shelter. And what they end up asking from him lines up with the stuff that he wanted to do, so it's a win-win relationship. And he didn't mind the fact that they were using his power. Hearing this, Sylphie calmed down. Aira was looking way better now. It seemed that she was happy that Kosuke forgave her. Then he reached out his hand. She was a bit surprised. Well, she didn't know about his world's manner. He told them it's a handshake, an important ritual for friends who make up after a fight or when they want to show goodwill. Then Aira shyly shake Kosuka's hand. At that moment, everyone felt the atmosphere became very calm and peaceful. He then offered both Sylphie and Melty a handshake and made them all feel way better. Then Sylphie told Kosuke that they will continue to rely on him for crafting items, and tomorrow they finally will go for a gizmo hunt. Later at night, Kosuke was in his workshop as usual. Today he seemed pretty quiet. Because of his carelessness, he ended up offending Aira. He only managed to avoid the worst because Aira was a sweet and innocent girl with kind personality. To any other craftsman, his abilities would be a great threat. He even thought about using his power less than before. But then Sylphie changed his mind. She said his craft abilities are very important for them and to leave the smaller details to her. She didn't want him to restrict himself for them. Kosuke told her if that's what she want, he was obliged. She told Kosuke she will protect him from anything, so he shouldn't worry about this too much. Even if he were to get chased out because of his power, she will still be on Kosuka's side. Kosuke was a bit embarrassed by her words. If she is willing to go that far, then he doesn't have any other choice. Kosuke then crafted some splints and prepared his crossbow and arrowheads for tomorrow, since he wants to take part in their gizmo's hunt. Then Sylphie suggested to get in bed early tonight, and Kosuke was ready but only after their lovely bedtime. Survival day 8, everyone were ready to hunt. Gizma and Harpies were in the sky to watch over them. Suddenly Kyubi noticed something and warns Sylphie and Kosuke to stop. Both of them were prepared for the enemy. Then Kyubi picks up a stick from the ground. He throws it towards an empty space, and when it makes the contact, suddenly a Gizma rams towards the stick, and Kosuke realized this was in Gizma's ambush tackle. The cloud of dust dissolved and a Gizma rushed at them. It was time to fight the enemy. Sylphie drew the blade and was going to attack Gizmas from behind and told them to keep it busy. Kosuka's strategy was simple, shoot and run. He was very good at shooting, thanks to his abilities. Kyubi and Kosuke shot at once. It landed straight on the Gizma, but it wasn't enough to kill the monster. The Gizma rushed right at Kosuke, but he wasn't going to run away. He had an idea. Kyubi told him to retreat, but he was going to face the enemy with his perfect plan. The Gizma jumped at Kosuke, but he wasn't a fool. He put the block right in front of the monster, and the Gizma's head smashed on it. It actually looked a bit disgusting, and Sylphie didn't even get to do anything. Kosuke honestly didn't think it would go this well. Well, he actually wanted to use Mr. Wood Spike, but thought they wouldn't work against Gizmas. They had no idea what he meant by Mr. Wood Spike. Kosuke then pulled out a barricade made of wood spikes. Seeing this, they to had doubt whether this could stop the Gizmas. Then Kosuke collected the Gizma's corpse, and Sylphie decided to move on to hunt others. A while later they followed their strategy. It was simple. Kyubi was baiting monsters to attack, and then Kosuke was using blocks to blow their heads. If it was still alive, Sylphie would deal the final blow, killing the insects from behind. That was pretty easy. Kosuke was glad their plan worked well. Later he thinks about adding stakes to the wall, and digging a deep trench with more Mr. Wood Spike at the bottom, and add in a large amount of crossbows, adding more to the defense. He also thought about adding an underground tunnel for if the wall is breached. Then Kosuke got an idea. He puts one blocks above another. No one had an idea what he was trying to do. Then pulls out a pickaxe and destroyed the bottom block. And voila, it's ready. Both Sylphie and Kyubi just accepted they were seeing. Kosuke felt the block, which seemed pretty stable, and jumped. He just broke the law of universal gravitation. Both expected something like that, but they still were astonished. Kosuke thinks that this would be great for building a floating base. He jumps down thinking he had taken enough of their time. Seeing him act so casual, now they understood Aira's feelings. They couldn't stop getting surprised by Kosuka's ability. Both Kyubi and Sylphie got alerted. They heard the roars of more than two Gizmas. Maybe one of the other recons have found a group of Gizmas. Kyubi, Sylphie and Kosuke headed to the place where the sound was from. There might be three, no, four or even more enemies. After hearing a large noise by the tree line, Kyubi pointed toward the area and they marched forward. A bunch of Gizmas were running behind the squirrel girl and the snake girl, who was carrying the lizard girl on her back while running away from Gizmas. The squirrel girl tells the others to keep on going as she will try to keep the Gizmas off them. She climbs on a tree and tries to get their attention. The Gizmas momentarily stops, then rams the tree very hard. After another one rams the tree, she loses her balance and was falling down by the Gizmas. Sylphie noticed her at the right moment. She gave a command to Kyubi and Kosuke to focus on getting the Gizmas' attention. They raise their crossbow and immediately shoots at them, and it distracts them enough for Sylphie to attack and chop off the Gizma's head easily. Then Kosuke tells her he will deal with the ones chasing after the others. The snake girl was almost about to get attacked, but Kosuke was there to save them. He told the girls to calm down and get behind him. The moment that Gizma jumped at Kosuke, he put the block in front of him. The insect got hit but didn't die. Then Kosuke jumps on the block and shoots the arrow into the Gizma's head, killing it for now. Then he takes the corpse into his inventory. Both Kyubi and Squirrel Girl were finished dealing with the Gizma, and Sylphie too was done dealing with the last one. Now they were safe from this massive attack. Everyone looked fine, except for the lizard girl. She was badly injured. She broke her leg very badly, even her bones were visible. Kosuke realized, earlier he made a splint, plus Aira already gave her seal of approval on the potions he made, so he was very confident in what he was about to do. Kosuke took her leg and told her to not move, then he used the potion to wash the parts covered in blood. Looking at her expressions, he didn't know whether she was in pain or not. Then it was time to use the splint, though he never used it before. Suddenly a pop-up appeared. He pressed the button and then his body started doing all the work by itself. The snake girl tried to complain. But suddenly the healing process began. The lizard girl was shocked by how she started feeling better. Her leg was straightening out on its own, much to the group's amazement. and then after a few seconds the splint disappeared. The lizard girl's leg was healed successfully. Then Kosuke offered her to take a healing potion for precautions. The snake girl and squirrel girl had no words to describe their feelings at that moment. And when the lizard girl got up and started jumping, both were surprised to see the fracture heal that fast. Both of them lost their mind and couldn't wrap their head around this. What the heck was that? The lizard girl bowed down and thanked Kosuke for his help. She thought she would have no other choice but to amputate her leg, and he was glad to help. Kosuke told her to not move too much since she must have lost a lot of blood, and it might take some time to recover. Sylphie then asked them, how much did they end up killing? And they replied, they got 2, so by adding their own hunts they had 13 so far. That was probably enough for now, so then they headed back to the village. When they came back to the camp, they met Danin. He told them even though the crossbow can pierce the gizmos, depending on where it hits, it could take more than 10 shots to finish them off. Then the squirrel girl informs that even as a group composed of 3 people, they were only able to hit them twice each. That's only if they take them by surprise. But after that they have to rush in to pick them off, plus there's the chance of attracting more gizmos. Hearing this, Kosuke think that the other unit lacks firepower necessary to finish them off in one go like him and Sylphie. For everyone's safety, Sylphie then offered others to form 6-member groups. Danin agrees to this. Then he immediately heads to tell the other about the formation change. Kosuke noticed that Danin had some problems with his leg. Kosuke asked him to wait. Then he tells him to sit down and show him his leg first. Danin wanted to go and inform everyone about the change, but others told him to calm down and wait for some time. Then Kosuke took a splint. Danin was surprised. What was he about to do? He was sure it wouldn't work. There's no way a splint is gonna fix an injury like his. He was yelling at them to stop, but when the process of healing started, he realized there was a miracle happening right now. Everyone just smiled. And when the healing process ended, Danin realized he didn't feel any pain. What did you just do? I healed it. With a smug smile, Kosuke tells him that. Then he told him to drink up the healing potion. Danin was unsure about this, but he drank it anyway. The medicine didn't taste as bad as he expected. Then Kosuke asks him, how's your leg? Danin got up and realized that he felt way better than before, and he tried to move his leg and was amazed that he can bend his leg. He couldn't believe it was for real. He felt like it was a trick of the fairies. Then he walked away with the word, I will thank you properly later. The others saw Danin smile, which is a rare thing. Sylphie still couldn't believe that he fixed Danin's leg that easily. Then Kosuke tells her that he could heal everyone else with limb ailments. Then Sylphie ordered Kyubi to gather everyone. Kosuke then thinks it would be great if he can cure everyone, because it will boost their fighting strength and not to mention his popularity. But he still didn't expect it to actually be this effective. Sylphie wanted to distribute the gizmo meat, so she tells the others to call Melty. Later when Melty arrives, she saw a lot of gizmo's meat and asks, how much is there? Sylphie tells her that they will be distributing about 9 of them for now, so 1 wheelbarrow won't be enough. That's really a lot. Even if they salt, then they won't be able to store it for long. Then Sylphie had a better idea to keep all this meat in Kosuka's inventory. Well, he wasn't happy with her idea, but he had no choice. Then Melty asked Kosuke to store 2 bags of potatoes into his inventory. Well, he was happy that Melty wasn't his master. In that case, he would definitely be worked to the bone and died from fatigue. After some time, a group of injured refugees were gathered in front of a tent, and one by one they kept entering. Eira was watching Kosuke heal each patient. Kosuke calls for the next to come. Suddenly, Eira gets an idea. She asks Kosuke to let her treat the next patient. She thinks that there must be some kind of secret to how the splints work. With that, there a rabbit girl with broken leg enters the tent. Her knees were hurt by Gizma's antenna. Eira wraps bandage around her legs. Then she asks her, how is it? She replies, nothing's happening. In the first place, knee has lots of delicate bones, so the rabbit girl knows at this point splint isn't gonna work. Then Kosuke asked Eira that now it's his turn, as he rustle up the work. Suddenly the process of healing immediately started. The rabbit immediately felt something has started to happen. Eira was shocked to see the rabbit's injury getting healed. The rabbit started to jump and yes, her legs doesn't hurt anymore. When Kosuke looked at Eira's face, he saw her being amazed like she was looking at a miracle. He decided to leave her be for a while, and Eira stayed like that until they were done. Later at the lunch table, everyone's reaction were like Eira's, but it doesn't mean they weren't happy. On the contrary, the more Kosuke can do with his powers, the better the situation will be in the village. Later, the warriors were coming back from the hunt, and thank God there were no injured ones among them. So now they needed to think up what to do next. Sylphie was worrying if it's a good idea to take Kosuke for their gizmo hunt. By any chance, if he dies, they would be heavy loss. Kosuke was thinking about what to do in this situation. Then he had some ideas about upgrading the defense. First, they will need to increase their range of vision and a way to obstruct the gizmo's charge. They might also have to fend them off at night, so they need a way to light up the surroundings. So how was he going to do that? With a smug look, he replies, "I'll craft torches." Everyone just looks at him with bewilderment. Kosuke sets up the torch on the block. That was his plan. He wanted to install this everywhere. This can stop the gizmo and lights up the area. Looking at it, Sylphie thinks this might work. Kyubi and Eero were trying to understand how this torch was standing on this block without any support. And while at it, Kosuke thinks about chopping down some trees to expand their vision as well. Sylphie said she didn't want to cut too much trees, but Kosuke convinced her they have no choice, and anyway this part of the forest will be destroyed after the gizmo's attack. Sylphie gave up on that point, and he started his work. It was almost night, but it wasn't dark. Kosuke had done everything he wanted. He created a vast open space, and all the territory was lighted with the torches. Sylphie was sad that they destroyed too much trees today. Well, the defense near the walls was upgraded very well, and now no gizmos would be able to break through it. Then Kyubi asked Kosuke, why none of the torches seem to be burning out? He just tells her that's how torches are, you know. Sylphie just accepted what she heard. She stopped getting surprised at some point. On the other hand, Eero was staring at this miracle, an everlasting flame. Then Sylphie told the guards to watch the walls during the night, so they can get some rest. Kosuke glanced at the moon. He was wondering why the moon was red. He asked Sylphie, is it just him, or is the moon red? According to her, it looks normal. Eero too didn't notice the moon being red. It looks more yellow tonight, but Kosuke was sure it's red and it meant only one thing. The large waves of enemies are coming. In other words, it's a sign that there's about to be a huge enemy raid, and we see a large group of gizmos marching. A loud rumbling was heard near the tree lines. The soldiers were armed with crossbows ready to shoot the enemy. The gizmos rushed into attack. Once they saw the insects, they shot the rain of arrows, which was quite useful in stopping the gizmos. Kosuke was watching the scene from the wall. He was glad his defense was working that nice. Jijiro was happy too, as she had struck one down. We've got strength in numbers, as she loads another arrow. Kosuke tells her it's not just weapon itself, but the sheer number of people using it that makes it shine. Another row of arrows were fired. There were a lot of gizmos attacking them, but they were dying faster than them getting close to the walls. And even the refugees were very good at reloading it pretty fast. Jijiro tells him that demi-humans are quite strong, so even if they use the improved version of crossbow, it won't affect the time it takes for them to reload. Then Kosuke started thinking about making more upgraded crossbows for them. On the other side of the wall, Danin was giving orders to the guards to not let them get closer. They were firing as he commands. Thanks to Kosuke clearing up the forest and lighting territory, it was easy to shoot the enemy despite it being nighttime. Kosuke thought that they may end up wiping them all out before the spirit archers get a shot at them, and Jijiro agrees on that. Then Melty calls out to Kosuke. She tells him that they need more bolts. Well, by simple maths, he realized that the amount of arrows they had was enough only for 10 minutes maximum. So he gave them some more arrows from his inventory. Melby was surprised to see that much. Then he saw Jijiro reached out her hand. She smiles and draws her hand closer. Kosuke realized she was standing nearby him just because she could access as many bolts as she wants. Well, it wasn't bad, so he gave her another 100 arrows. Kosuke wonders about how long would it take before the gizmo's meat spoils. Melty answered, it roughly takes half of the day before gizmo meat starts rotting. Then Kosuke decided to collect some meat. Yes, right at the battlefield. Bro's a madman. He thinks that if they gather some of the people who are good at fighting, it will probably be fine. And the gizmo meat's pretty good too, so it'd be a waste to let them spoil. Kosuke heads to the temporary headquarters. Danin notices Kosuke getting up. He asked him, what happened? Then Kosuke told him his idea. Danin thinks about it, and orders the others to assemble a squad composed of those skilled in close-range combat, and he orders Werg to take command here. If it's close quarters, then I shall be joining you. Gelda with a smile reaches for her sword. Looking at her, Kosuke remembers her as Gelda-san. But the sword that she carries doesn't match up with her. It seems it could snap in a second. She was embarrassed to say this, but he was right. It's pretty hard for her to control the strength. Well, he already knows about that because she was quite big after all. Even the long sword in her hand looks more like short sword. Kosuke realized he can make a special weapon for her. She requested a powerful mace with a huge shield. Kosuke confirms about the weapon and heads towards the forge. He was looking for something that looks like the mace, but there was nothing similar to that. Then he tried to imagine it properly, and the mace suddenly appeared in the craft window. That wasn't too hard to make it. Then he made a huge shield. But Kosuke also wanted to make some kind of weapon for himself. He had some ideas and he starts crafting. Then Sylphie approached Kosuke and asks if he was actually going. Well, it would be a waste to leave all those meats there when they can use them. Kosuke then gave Gelda her new equipment and she was very happy. She started swinging her long mace, which generated a very scary sound and wind. He then brings out his weapon. It was a bit too heavy for him. Sylphie asked to give it a try and she was swinging it easily like a wooden stick. He was wondering how powerful this girl is. Now it was time to head out. Danon and others gathered near the gates. He introduced Miss Samo, the reptile. She was Danon's mentor and the Melinard Army's spear instructor. She greets Kosuke, but he still couldn't read a lizard man's facial expression. And the next is Sir Leonard. He's famous within the kingdom and he earned the nickname of Dual Sword. Looking at him, Kosuke thinks he might be a noble because of the way he was being addressed. Then it's the big girl named Siomo. She earned the nickname Mincemaker, and she used to be an adventurer. She was glad to meet Kosuke. These soldiers will help Kosuke to collect the Gizma's meat safely. Aero was about to help him too. He never saw her magic, so it will be for the first time. He thinks maybe she'll will shoot a beam out of her eye or something. Sylphie and Kosuke looked at each other. It meant they were ready. Everyone was ready too. Sylphie tells everyone that their objective is to protect Kosuke, since he will be the one to collect the Gizma's corpse. Then the gates were opened. Kosuke was collecting the Gizma's corpse. Seeing him collect all these so instantly, Sir Leonard was baffled by his powers. Siomo too couldn't quite get what she was watching. It was very different from the traditional magic, Danon told her. Yes, Kosuke doesn't have any magic. Siomo gets how he feel because she too can barely use any magic. Contrary to others, Miss Samo was on guard, as she looks around telling them to not put their guard down, because the Gizmas are quite good at surprise attacks. Gerda agrees with her, but she really wanted to try out her new weapon. Looking at the splendid weapon, Miss Samo was a bit jealous. She asked Danon, did Kosuke made his weapon too? Indeed he did, master, and Danon holds out his bardiche. Miss Samo stares at Kosuke. Well, he usually have a hard time reading a lizard folk's expression, but he can tell this time for sure. Even Sir Leonard wanted to have a proper sword for himself, and Siomo, who was using a log as a weapon, wanted something new as well. The dual swords were battered, the spear was rusted, and one of the weapon was just a giant log. The trio stared at Kosuke wanting to have new weapons. Kosuke looks at Sylphie for help, but she simply nodded. Just do it. Well, now that he had Sylphie's permission, he'll make the weapons they want. The trio were pleased to hear that. Suddenly a loud screech echoed. It looks like they have company. Kosuke thought they should make a run for it, but the warriors had some other suggestion. There won't be any need for that, Sir Leonard replied. There's simply no chance of getting surrounded or overwhelmed by them. The old man isn't wrong, Siomo chimed in. Sylphie told Kosuke, don't mind us and focus on collecting the Gizma corpses. Greta then takes the front and Miss Samo proceeds to flank them, as the Gizmas were approaching them at full speed. Kosuke thought that even though the Gizma are attacking, he thinks that he'll be pretty safe. With a loud thud, Greta blocked the Gizma's hit, and the others procs to attack. Danon slices the head of the Gizma with the bardiche, and Greta blocks a Gizma's hit with the shield, and smashes the other with her mace. Sir Leonard slowly walks towards the Gizma while blocking his Antina's attack, as the monster was about to attack again. With a sharp sight, he swings his sword, slicing the Gizma head with ease, while Miss Samo stabs the Gizma's head with her rusty spear. Siomo, on the other hand, simply bashes the Gizma with her giant log, obliterating it. Sir Leonard tells her not to turn them into paste. Then a bright light catches Kosuke and Sylphie's attention. Aero was chanting a magic spell surrounded by bright lights. Fulminate thunderstorm, as she speaks. Lightning comes out of her staff, electrifying the Gizmas. Kosuke was shocked, and the Gizmas were toasted by Aero's attack. Amazing! It's magic! Look, Sylphie! Kosuke was excited. Sylphie remembers, it was his first time properly seeing magic. Until now, the only magic he had seen was when she healed him. Sylphie tells him, Aero's destruction magic is truly at another level. It's not something you see normally. Aero was smug because she got praised by the princess. Kosuke wonders that everyone keeps saying that he is an interesting person, but isn't everyone here way more interesting than him? Kosuke then tense up since Agisma was behind Sylphie. She tells him it's all about training, as long as one practices. She turns back and smashes the Gizma's head, shocking Kosuke. She tells him if have that much time to think, then he should be collecting instead. And Kosuke agrees. After some time, Kosuke and all the warriors were heading back to the base. They managed to gather 216 gizmas. Melty will probably be very happy about this. Not just Melty, but the rest of the refugees will be happy too, Sylphie replies. That aside, Sir Leonard have been feeling that his blade has already reached his limit, and Miss Zamo feels the same. Both of them stares at Kosuke with hope. Siumo adds that she will be fine with anything as long as it's big and durable. Sylphie too wanted a weapon with bit more reach. Era pulls Kosuka's shirt, and tells him that she too want a staff made from that. Kosuke remembers the mithril he gave her earlier, but he wasn't sure if he can craft a staff with the stuff he have. Era then leaves to bring a diagram for Kosuke, then he shouts to not make it too complicated since he might not be able to make it. Kosuke then asks the others what exactly they want with their weapon. Hearing this, they all looked very pleased. Then they tell Kosuke about how they want their weapons to be made in specific details. Kosuke then asks Sylphie, what kind of weapon does she want? Sylphie was happy with anything that Kosuke makes, but he wanted her to decide it on her own. After thinking for a while, she reminds him of the weapon he mentioned earlier, a talwar. Later at the forge, he remembers he did recommended her something like that. Then he looks at his inventory and thinks, if he is already going to make a mithril staff, then why not just make the talwar out of mithril as well? He wasn't sure what might happen to the mithril ore, but he was eager to try it out. Day 9th of survival, Pilna was back from surveying the area from the sky. She informs Sylphie that there were no signs of gizmas in the surrounding area. The gizmas attack occasionally, but as soon as the sky brightened, the attack completely stops. It seems that they have survived the night. Some more good news. Sir Leonard got his new twin sword which were perfect. Miss Samra was happy with her new spear and Simo got her new weapons, but it was sad that they couldn't test it out right now. Kosuke was glad to see their happiness. But there was one more who looked quite disappointed, but not to worry since there was a special one for Sylphie. Looking at the sword, it can't be. She immediately realized what it was. She quickly drew the blade. Everyone instantly got shocked. A mithril blade so beautiful. Sylphie asked if he have a name for this weapon. Kosuke actually didn't think about that. Well, he made this under the blue-white moon. So maybe something like moonlight or blue moon. No, pale moon. Pale moon sounds great. It was as beautiful as the blade itself. Sylphie declared that the name of the sword would be Pale Moon, and everyone claps. Kosuke thought it was unexpectedly going well, and Aira explained that the mithril swords were only for royal family members, and the fact that a Marabito made it will boost its stock even more. Wait, how did she appear here so unexpectedly? Kosuke was shocked. Aira brought here a blueprint design for the magic staff. Then Sylphie asked Kosuke to pull out the Gizma's corpse here. She wanted to test her new blade out. He quickly pulled it out of his inventory. Sylphie swung the blade, and it easily got right through the Gizma. Everyone was staring at how Gizma's body was getting separated by little pieces. Awesome. Aren't that just too sharp? Kosuke thought. Sylphie needed to get more training to not accidentally chop off her own limbs. Sir Leonardo and Miss Zamaru offered Her Majesty to train with them later. Kosuke had been working hard all this time, so now he wanted to go to rest. He put some things to craft and sat down waiting for it to be done. Suddenly he remembers something. It's been a long time since he last looked at his levels and skills. He opens the achievements window thinking something interesting might have appeared here. He was at level 12 and his stats were pretty good. He also had 12 skill points, so he could increase something he needed the most. He didn't want to think too much, and just did it quickly. Next step are the achievements. It looked like he had unlocked a lot than earlier. Most of them were new, like crafting something for the first time and killing monsters. All the buffs were pretty cool, so nice, and of course there were some achievements he didn't expect to see. He got an achievement called Womanizer. He was favored by more than 5 girls, so basically a harem. Kosuke was embarrassed by this. He haven't even done anything wrong, so how can this happen? Moreover, once he imagined it, he realized how huge his harem might be at the moment. There might be even those elven elders. No, better to not think about that. He already have Sylphie with him, so how could he think about such things? There also was another interesting achievement. He survived the Red Moon Knight for the first time, and for that now he was able to upgrade his skills level. It looked interesting. Tonight Kosuke told Sylphie that their village may be attacked every 7 days. While he might be just imagining things, at least he hoped so. Nonetheless, they should strengthen their defenses, so he'd like to do that as the next step. Sylphie said she would ask Danan and the elders about strengthening the wall defense, and they of course would help with resources gathering. Kosuke thanks Sylphie for being so kind. She said it was just a trivial thing. It's natural for her to understand the things he was worried about, since it's the only way they can work for everyone's benefit. Then Kosuke gets up. He said he have to go to make a magic staff for Ira. But suddenly Sylphie grabbed his hand. He turned around to say something, but she suddenly kissed him. The kiss scene is a bit too raunchy, so you should check it yourself. By the way, it's chapter 18. Sylphie didn't like him talking about other girls in her presence. Kosuke apologized for being like that, but now she was too excited to stop. She was going to discipline a bad slave who can't think of the master's first need. Then she suddenly picks him and headed to the bedroom. That night opened a new world for Kosuke. Bro's booty got a whole new experience. After that wild night, Kosuke felt embarrassed. It was so painful to remember. Sylphie told him to wake up, as it was time to leave, and judging by that morning glow, Sis really enjoyed that night. Day 11th, Kosuke was working hard while smelting new items. On day 12th, the elf elders were arguing about their respective sizes. Let's not get into that. On day 13th, the trio were still asking for their mithril weapons. And by day 14th, their walls were fortified. On the 15th day of the survival, they were prepared for the Red Moon Night. However, the moon was still normal. From what Pilna said, there were no gizmas around the forest. Even in the Omit Wilderness, they hadn't noticed them too much. Kosuke noticed that the moon was especially beautiful tonight. Sylphie agreed with him. She wanted to see the pale and the blue-white moon, but she was fine with this one too. Well, it seemed like the Red Moon occurrence wasn't like from the game, so they don't have to worry about it in the near future. But it didn't mean that their hard work was useless. In the end, they have a really powerful wall that could easily withstand enemies' attack. Kosuke guessed that now Sylphie wanted to get her kingdom back. Well, it wasn't hard to guess since she was thinking of it from the beginning. And to her surprise, Kosuke didn't mind helping her. Moreover, he wanted to make their relationship stronger. She was surprised by his words. But they still weren't strong enough to handle the entire kingdom since they only have 300 people at most. On the contrary, the kingdom has a whole army stationed. But Kosuke was very calm about the situation. He was confident in his abilities. Sylphie tells him that listening to his speech make it sound so easy. Well, he was just an optimistic guy. Then Sylphie thought of something and made an important decision. She was going to take the kingdom of Marinard back. Looking at her, Kosuke can see the pure determination in her eyes. When Sylphie told her plan, everyone was astonished by what she said. Kyubi was happy to see the princess back to her old self. Suma was sick and tired of being looked down upon, and Sir Leonard and Miss Zamoru were happy enough to wield their weapon for their highness. However, Danan and Melty knew they couldn't fight against the kingdom that easily. The discussion naturally led towards the many issues that needed to be dealt. And since they can only rely on Kosuka's abilities, the discussion ended immediately. Few days later, Kosuke, who's supposed to be focusing on their survival, was now going to the Omit Wilderness as part of the forward unit. Here Kosuke made a little landmark to not forget where they were. Their objective was to measure the distance they traveled before sundown. Here Kosuke made his 8th landmark. Now it was time to find an appropriate location to establish a fort. They have traveled quite a distance from the village, and based on where they are, it roughly take 10 days to travel back there. By looking at the map, we can see the progress they made, and if a battle ensues, these landmarks can be a game changer. Suddenly Sir Leonard puts his hand on Kosuke's shoulder. He humbly asks Kosuke if could perhaps forge a mithril sword especially for him, and Miss Samur got mad at him for trying to get a head start. But since she wanted it too, they both gave a very good reason for wielding the mithril weapons, but the aura they emitted was so extreme that Kosuke couldn't handle it. But then a very loud explosive sound distracted them, so they looked back. It was a new weapon made by Kosuke, an US Springfield bolt-action rifle. Jijiro was totally in love with it. But well, Kosuke told her to not shoot too much since they don't have many bullets. Other than Jijiro, no one seems like this weapon, since it was pretty loud. Still, the power has is definitely quite something. After all, it was effective enough to take down a gizma in just 2 shots. Sylphie told Kosuke to take the monster's meat to the inventory. Then Sir Leonard asked Sylphie if she had decided on the location yet. She pointed towards a hill with the pointy rocks. It looked like the highest point in this desert, and the location was easily defensible. Sylphie pointed toward the building location, and Kosuke agreed with them. He started preparing for build, but first they needed to prepare a camp to sleep tonight. Kosuke started his work. First he needed to make the landscape flat, which was done pretty quick. By the way, he unlocked a new ability. Now he can place a bunch of blocks at once. Seeing him place the wall on one side and another wall appearing on the other side, Sylphie was surprised. She never expected something like this. After a while, the entire house was done, although the interiors was pretty much empty. Now it was time to build a protective wall. Kosuke laid out the base blocks, and then he digged about 5-block deep trench from the wall. Seeing him work, Jijaira thought, even if they all worked like this, they would still never be able to match his pace. On the other hand, Kosuke filled the trench with solid blocks to prevent underground attacks, and for the above he built a 3-block wide wall, a bastion at every corner, and finally the gate. Voila, the base is complete. No one expected for the base to complete it in a single day, but well, they had Kosuke. Now that they had a lot of free time, Sylphie told everyone to inspect the walls from the outside and tell her if they would find any problem with it. Then Kosuke started making stairs so that they can get on the wall. Somehow he noticed that someone was standing behind him. His instinct was telling him to flee. As they were about to catch him, Kosuke tried to run away from them, and they started chasing him. But he was faster than they expected him to be. Kosuke decided to build up, and the next moment he was at the top. Sir Leonard and Miss Zamaru were smiling, while telling him to come down. Kosuke told them that he is just a slave, so he can't hand out mithril weapons without Sylphie's permission. He told them to ask her about that if they really want their weapons. Both of them just stared at Kosuke, while he was thinking about how to get out of this situation. Pilna appeared out of nowhere. She told Kosuke that she came here to help. She can just pick him up and get him out of this place real quick. He was happy to hear that. However, there was a condition. She was ready to help him only if he would make a weapon especially for her, and here Kosuke thought that she was on her side. But for Kosuke help, Sylphie was back. She had a lot of questions for them, like, what was going on? And seeing his savior, Kosuke came down and rushed towards Sylphie's safety. Realizing that this mess was caused by Kosuke, she punched him hard in the stomach. Then Sir Leonard and Miss Zamaru asked Sylphie straightly to let Kosuke forge a mithril weapons especially for them. Sylphie sighed. She acknowledged their service, but she can't exactly hand out mithril weapons so easily, since no nation there would do so freely. Hearing this, Kosuke thought, doesn't that mean that he was essentially a living national treasure? He was getting a bad feeling about this. Then Sylphie tells him that there may be a time when she can't be beside him, and she have no doubts that every member of the group would be there to help him. So she wanted him to listen to their requests if possible. In exchange, they will protect him at all costs, even if it'll cost their life. Kosuke gets up thinking that if he did this, pretty important big shots of Melinard are gonna essentially be his bodyguard. Alright, he agrees to make those mithril weapons for them. Sir Leonard and Miss Zamaru were very happy, but there also was Pilna, who looked really sad and disappointed. But Kosuke had some good news to raise her mood. He just have a perfect thing that a harpy would be able to use. Pilna was immediately cured from her depression, but what was this weapon? Kosuke puts down a hand grenade on the table. It's called a potato masher, used during the World War 1 and 2. Everyone looked at the weapon on the table. How am I supposed to use this? Pilna asked. They probably won't understand if he explains, so Kosuke thought it would be faster to show them everything. He then tells them to follow him to the wall. A strong explosion astonished everyone. That was amazing. Pilna was excited. She wanted the harpies to use this weapon. Kosuke said, it's called the hand grenade. He showed them how to use it. First, pop off the safety cap from the bottom, then wrap that around your finger, and then just throw it. Another explosion. This time the surrounding logs were blown away. Kosuke told Pilna, once she pulls the string, there's no way to stop it from exploding, so be careful with it. She was happy to get a weapon that she and other harpies could use. Kosuke tied up the string on her foot and warned her about what he said earlier. Pilna was going to test it out. She flew out far enough and then threw the grenade. The explosion was as expected. Now she got an idea about how to throw it. This time she flew way high and dived straight down. Using the momentum, she threw the grenade. And boom! The wooden logs were blown away by the impact, that their sharp parts were going through other logs. Pilna was glad her new weapon works that great. Everyone realized how powerful this weapon was. This'll surely change how the battles will be fought. Kosuke praised Pilna as she did a very good job. Then he asked Sylphie, what does she think about it? But Sylphie was deep in her thought. Kosuke asked her if everything was okay while she was thinking about something. With a hungry cry from Jujaira, they decided to head back, since the sun had already set. Everyone gathered near Kosuka's crafting area. He started crafting food in his workbench. It was hamburgers, or more like gizma burgers. They agreed that it looks appetizing, and the taste actually was great. Some even thought that it tasted like a roasted or seared beef, and Kosuke thought he shouldn't tell them what it was made out of. He was just happy to see them eat the food that he made. After the dinner, Sylphie told Kosuke to tell them about today's plan. He said that he wanted Jujaira and Pilna to do something important. Then he put a lot of ammo on the table. He asked Jujaira to shoot a gun until it doesn't work anymore, a durability test basically. He explains that a gun starts to wear down after a while from constant shooting, and if she finds out the exact amount, in future he might be able to come up with some sorts of upgrade. In a worst case scenario, the gun itself might suddenly explode. But it didn't stop Jujaira. Her eyes were lit up with excitement. She grabbed the ammo and rifle and rushed to test it out. Well, someone is certainly lively. Then Kosuke pulled out a case full of hand grenades. He wanted to see how many could Pilna carry without any problem. Kosuke then assigned Miss Samru with Pilna to help her carry the grenades. Now it was time to continue working on their base while Pilna was preparing for the test. Kosuke had already built a lot of houses. Seeing this, Sir Leonard and Sylphie were wondering how crazy can his abilities get. Sometimes later he finished another building. Now they have 20 barracks, which should be good for now. As per the request, he made 4 double rooms with a living room on each floor. So each building can house 16 people just fine, which means with 20 buildings, in total they can house 320 people with ease. Then Kosuke was reminded of something. He started digging holes, and Danan asked, what was he planning to do? Well, he just remembered that there should be some toilet and stuff. Yup, he was a big fan of sanitation. He had also worked on the toilets back in the village. Well, there was nothing wrong with some proper hygiene. It will bring down the number of people getting sick. Well, no one can argue with that. He placed a septic tank of sorts and started placing toilets. He did it really quickly and it looks nice. It's a bit basic, but it should be good enough for now. Then Kosuke went on to put down some more toilet around the base. Sometime later, Kosuke started working on the well. Can you breathe down there? Sylphie asked. Yup, to be honest, it feels much cooler down here. Well, it was because Sylphie was using her spirit magic to divert cool breeze down the hole. Feeling motivated, he dug straight down. Then he cleared the surrounding blocks and replaced them with stones. He continued digging and finally found what he was looking for. He found the source of water at the same depth as the other ones. Now it was time to go back up, so now they have 4 wells at their base at each corner. Then Kosuke was surprised by the fact Sylphie can check the water's quality by using magic. He also noticed that there were no trees and grass for some reason in this place, even when there's water right near the surface. Sylphie then tells him that it was because of spirit stone overusage, which has caused the spiritual balance of the land to overturn, making this a barren wasteland. Kosuke wasn't happy with this news. After hearing about the spirit stone, he started to get a bit worried about it. Suddenly Kosuke remembered another thing he should have done. Sir Leonard asks, what are you planning on making this time? A farm, he replied, while tilling the ground. Sir Leonard inspected the soil and realized how good it was. Well, he just took some dirt from the Black Forest and brought it here. Honestly, he wouldn't be surprised if the crops were fully harvested within 3 days. Then he pulled out a hoe and started working on the land. By the looks on their face, they were definitely surprised, and by looking at Kosuka's speed, they now understand how Era and Malti felt. After a few minutes, Kosuke was done with his job. Now it was time to plant some seeds. And after a few seconds, they already could see some sprouts growing. Well, this is Kosuke we're talking about. Now the only thing left was to water the field, so he dug a 4x4 area and replaced it with cobblestone. Then he poured 2 buckets of water on the opposite corner. And it's done. An infinite water source. Well, a craft game player like me and Kosuke can understand this. But this wasn't the case with Sir Leonard and Sylphie. They just witnessed the 2 buckets of water filling up the whole thing, and this definitely wasn't normal. Then Kosuke started filling up his buckets with water. Then Sylphie noticed that, no matter how many times the water gets drawn, the water level wasn't going down a bit. Sylphie was literally shook beyond belief, but Kosuke couldn't explain to her how he did it. He just told her it's just a strange well and nothing else, and it seems that she too didn't want to question this any further. Then Jijaira came back yelling that she went through all the ammos. Jijaira noticed Sylphie was looking a bit anxious. Well, after what she had seen, nobody would be able to act normally beyond that point. Jijaira had shot all the 500 rounds and didn't notice any problem with this rifle, and there's basically no loss in accuracy either. It was shooting as good as before. Kosuke was a bit surprised. He didn't expect it to be that good. Anyhow, he took the old weapon and handed her a new one to use. Jijaira was happy to get a new one, and now they can be rest assured that at least the rifles will last through a battle without any issues. Still, Kosuke wasn't sure if it's the design or if it's because he was the one who crafted it that made this rifle unbreakable. Then Pilna came back. She was astonished to see a field here, and there was something already sprouting from it. How? What happened here? Even Jijaira was shocked when she saw the field. Kosuke then asked Pilna how the test was. She said she tried a bunch of different ways, but this is the most she can carry comfortably. He checked it, and it was around 3 kilos. Kosuke asked her if it wasn't too much for her. Pilna said it's okay. If it's within 10 kilometers, she can carry this with ease. Kosuke realized she was holding it in a T shape, which made it easy for her to carry and throw around. Looking at it, Kosuke realized that it resembles more of an aerial bomb rather than a hand grenade. Sylphie was absorbed in her thought for some reason. Kosuke asked her what they needed to do next. When she heard his question, she offered to think the next move over some lunch. Then they all gathered over at Kosuka's crafting area. After the lunch, Sylphie decided to divide all of them in pairs, Sir Leonard with Miss Samaru and Jijaira with Pilna. They should all scout the area around the fort. Kosuke wanted to continue making more weapons, while Sylphie offered to stay here and guard him. All of them got their tasks for today and started to disperse. Let's get this bread, Kosuke encouraged them as they leaves. Then he immediately pulls out the crafting table and the forge. It was time to make some bombs for harpies. All he needed was to imagine the image of the item he wanted to create, and then the craft recipe of the bomb appeared in the window. It required about 3 times the materials, so 10 bombs would be enough for the starters. And then there's the 4x scope that he had been planning. Sylphie suddenly addressed Kosuke. It seemed that she wanted to ask him about something important. Are you really fine with all this? Sylphie was worried for him. Until now, he used to live in a peaceful country, and now he was making all this powerful military weapons for them. She was sad since she was the one who asked him for his help. However, Kosuke didn't even think about it too much. He has been focusing more on crafting the stuff. He was aware of the destruction his weapons can cause, but with these weapons, the Holy Kingdom will surely lose a lot of people. The only thing that might make him feel bad was the deaths that would happen soon because of his weapons, and since he was the one who brought this in this world, so all the deaths will be his responsibility and burden to carry. Maybe you will be sent to hell by God. Hell? Sylphie wasn't familiar with it. Kosuke told her it's a concept from the world he came from. Hell is the place where people who deserve to get tortured are sent, although there's no proof of its existence. Sylphie realized it's similar to the afterlife. People in this world believe that every dead person goes to the sky and turns into a star. Well, that's the romantic version of it at least. Then Sylphie added if he was sent to hell, then she would go there together with him. After all, she was the one who asked him to make the weapons. Kosuke had no idea whether he should be happy with that or not. Then Sylphie grabbed his hand and told him that if 2 people shares the burden, it'll only be half as heavy, and she would never let him suffer alone. From the look in her eyes, Kosuke was sure that she wasn't kidding. He got embarrassed because his mistress was such a kind person, so it means he must do as much good as possible so that God can lessen his punishment. Sylphie said that one should not only look at how to end life, but also look at how he can save more. And just as Sylphie said, their goal isn't to wipe out the Holy Kingdom, it's to take back the Melinard Kingdom itself. And killing is just a mean to achieve their goal. Although it's still easier to kill all the occupying forces than to let them live, Sylphie didn't even want to argue, because it's true. But anyways, first he wanted to make them realize their strength so they would understand it's better to not get in a conflict with them. Sylphie agreed. Their current plan was to build a fort near them and hold a defensive battle. While the harpies would launch an airstrike on their fort, then they would take down the remaining with the crossbows and hand grenade. Kosuke then displayed his new explosive weapon, a landmine. Once you trip over the wire, it explodes, launching tiny fragments at high speed. It sounds dangerous, so Sylphie didn't really like it. Well, it explodes regardless of who trips it, so Kosuke agreed with her on this. But there was still this. Then Kosuke put an interesting device on the ground. It was a TNT. If you light it up, it'll make a big explosion. Kosuke made one, but he still hadn't tested it out. If only he had a way to light them from a distance. Well, if only MC had redstone, things would have been different. Sylphie offered him to ask Aira for some help. While Kosuke already had an idea, if only he had a way to detonate it from a distance, then they could just let them take over the fort and blow them up from afar. Even Sylphie was surprised by his cruelty, but to him it sounded more like a compliment. She reminded him of the rifle and asked Kosuke if it was possible to improve it. With a smug look, he said he does have something, but it's not a bolt-action rifle anymore. Sylphie's eyes widen as he presents the new weapon. On the table, there were four different types of guns: a pistol, revolver, rifle, and a shotgun. Sylphie wanted to take a better look at it, and to her surprise, it was heavier than it actually looked. Kosuke told her the one she was holding was a revolver. It's meant for close range. Sylphie tries to aim it the same way Kosuke did. He further explains that it can fire 6 lead bullets in a row, and it has enough power to kill someone in one shot at close range. The one Kosuke was holding was a semi-automatic pistol. It can fire 8 rounds in quick succession. Sylphie wasn't sure if these small weapons could be useful in close combat. Then Kosuke explains that in his world, fighting with swords and spears are a thing of the past. Now everyone uses rifle and such. And if they ever have to fight in close range, they use pistols like revolver or the semi-automatic one. But Sylphie then wonders if these only hold 6 rounds, wouldn't that be an issue in a melee? Kosuke tells her that these kind of situations hardly ever happens in his world, and if someone ever tries to fight like that, he'd be filled with holes before he can get close. Sylphie then grabs a shotgun and asks, what about this big one? Well, that one's a pump-action shotgun. Then Kosuke grabs the other shotgun, which was a double-barrel shotgun. Sylphie asks him, what make this different from the bolt-action rifle? Kosuke told her that the shotgun uses different bullets, and it can shoot a bunch of bullets at once, like the pistol but with the smaller rounds. It's actually a weapon that is used for close-quarter combat, mainly used for clearing a building or sometimes in hunting. Sylphie now understood the uses of guns. So are these everything then? Nah, girl. Kosuke got some stuff to show. He then offered her to accompany him to the walls. At the top, he sets up a huge crossbow. It's called a ballista. The bolts it shoots are in the size of a spear. He shows her how to use it. First, turn the lever and pull the spring back. He then pulls out the arrow, which was as big as a spear. He then sets it up, and now all he had to do was fire. He pulls the lever. It launches a huge arrow and broke the stone, splitting it like it was nothing. Sylphie was impressed by that crazy strength, and Kosuke added that it can target much further than a crossbow with enough power to destroy a battering ram. But there was one more thing that was about to surprise her. Is that another gun? Nah, it is a cannon, Kosuke replies. It shoots bullets much larger than a gun, and it's much more powerful than the ballista he showed earlier. Kosuke pulls out some boxes of cannonballs and loads it inside. He tells her it's completely made of iron, so it's not cheap to make. Then wouldn't it be hard to mass produce? Sylphie asks. Well, it'd be much different if they had a mine or something, and he wasn't really sure if they needed to rely on this, since this world has magic which looks way more powerful than anything else. And he too had some internal struggle, but he kept that thought to the side and loaded the cannonball inside the cannon. Kosuke told Sylphie to cover her ears and... That was a very loud sound. Sylphie was astonished by how powerful it was. The place that it landed on was completely obliterated. She was puzzled and asked if shot a bunch of them? Well, it kinda works in the same way as that shotgun he showed earlier. But the only thing they could use now were the ballista. Plus, it shouldn't be too hard to figure out and use. As for Sylphie, she actually liked the revolver. And Kosuke promised to make one for her. He even tried to imagine her dressed as a cowgirl. Well, that dress does look quite good on her. Suddenly, Sir Leonard and Miss Samura ran up there. They heard that explosion and thought that something dangerous was happening here. Even the others came running after them. Well, they were on alert, so of course any loud sound would scare them. Kosuke apologized for that, and then he demonstrated his new weapons. Jijaira and Pilna were amazed, but Sir Leonard and Miss Samura didn't like it that much, since these lacked the dignity and honor of the weapons of a warrior. but then Sir Leonard thought that he could at least go against the pistol and challenge Kosuke to shoot at him. Kosuke wasn't too sure if this was right to do, but if he does get hurt, he could use the bandage on him and fix him up. Then Kosuke dumps a mag at them, and both easily deflected the bullets with their weapons. After he was done, Kosuke was shocked to see this. He thought, are they some kind of anime protagonist? Then Sir Leonard explained that just by following the barrel of the gun, he can predict the path of the bullets. And Miss Zamoru agrees that an attack from a true master would be more dangerous than these bullets. Jujaira chime in as well. Sylphie also thought that she would have no problem against a pistol, but the bolt-action rifle is too fast for them to deal with. Hearing their conclusion, Kosuke was just dumbfounded. He thought about whether it was a right decision to make these weapons. Well, they didn't think that way at all. The only thing they were worried about was if these weapons were ever used against them by any chance. Sylphie too was worried. If the Holy Kingdom got their hands on these weapons, it would be really bad. Kosuke too thought that aside from the crossbow, if they ever get their hands on the guns and the gunpowder, that would be the worst case scenario. Not to mention that this world has magic and alchemy, which could be used to re-engineer the weapons. Everyone there noticed Kosuke grumbling to himself, so they decided to leave him alone, because this usually take a while. Kosuke was thinking that he did make weapons that were efficient in killing people, but these very weapons could be recovered by the enemy and be used against them. So he wanted to find a new method to take back the kingdom without using force. Then Pilna suddenly calls for Kosuke. The field that Kosuke plowed suddenly grew big enough to be harvested, and by the looks of it, they will have no issue living in the Omit wilderness, since they have all their basic need fulfilled. 5 days later, they came back to the village with a lot of good news. Sylphie told everyone that they have constructed their first outpost, and within the walls they can house 300 peoples, with a source of clean water and food provided. Everyone was shocked. They had no words to say. Sylphie further tells them that with Kosuka's abilities they would have no problem with being self-sufficient, but their main priority is to take back the Melinard Kingdom as soon as possible. Well, it was because most of the refugees and Sylphie's family are still held hostage or enslaved. That's why she wants to take it back as soon as possible. Even if their numbers are few and they are far too weak, relying only on Kosuke's power alone isn't going to get them anywhere. And that's why with Kosuke's plan they will be strengthening their position within the Omit Wilderness. And while that's happening, the other party will infiltrate the Melinard Kingdom and liberate their people, adding to their strength. These were the plans that Kosuke came up with to take back the Melinard Kingdom, and surely the Holy Kingdom isn't going to just sit back, which is why the weapons he made will definitely come in handy. Sylphie then explains that the first step would be to send at least 50 people to their fort as a test, and to experiment with Kosuka's farm. And during that they will begin the construction of a second base. So how many bases do you want to build? Danan asked Sylphie. She replied that they will need about 3. One to keep a supply line and trade with the elf village, one as a main base of operations, and one to act as their frontline base. As for the vanguard fort, it wouldn't be too far away from the Melinard Kingdom, so it should be situated in the Omit Wilderness. Danan was a bit hesitant because they would have to be constantly vigilant of the Holy Kingdom, which was true, but they do have a lot of strong weapons that would give them a very high advantage in battle. However, they still need more people to maintain control of the area. And Sylphie told them how they planned to liberate all of the surrounding towns and villages while attempting to make contact with people. Danan was afraid that they were going to let the people they freed through the Omit Wilderness with nothing but clothes on their back. But Sylphie told him there's nothing to worry about since they have Kosuke. He can create some underground shelters for them to spend the nights, so they can cross safely. Now the plan sounded pretty solid and there were no problems, at least at the current point. Sylphie was pretty confident it would work. Then Meldy wanted to know more details about Kosuka's farm plan. Sylphie tells her to ask him herself. Once he heard that, he got scared. Sylphie did it intentionally to avoid answering Melty. She even looked away, making him feel as she dumped Melty onto him. Kosuke then pulled out some haystacks from his inventory. He tells her that these are the harvest he got from 1,000 square meters plot of farmland. Melty was very surprised. They were just gone for a week and he harvested this much. Suddenly her stare seems terrifying. Kosuke explained his whole process to her as much as he could. He further told her that he doesn't know what will happen if someone else were to plant the crops, which is why Sylphie wanted to do further testing. Melty understood him, and she have no other questions regarding the field. Anyway, it was still a miracle that he got that much harvest from just one field, and all the crops were of very high quality. Being able to harvest this quality and this quantity from a couple of fields in just 3 days, she quickly realized how she could exploit him, and looking at her, Kosuke could see himself working at a field for all eternity. Then Kosuke noticed Eira, who was as always had that dead-eyed stare again. She couldn't even imagine it being possible to get a harvest that quickly even with a special potion, and here appears a guy that does it with just using water. Sylphie then asked them if they had any more questions to ask, but it seemed that no one had any more questions left, except for Sumo, who wanted to know if they will be taking the fight to the Holy Kingdom yet. Well, they aren't going to do that yet, but what they will be doing is something that the Holy Kingdom won't like. Sumo didn't really care as long as they are still messing with them. Then that settles their plans. Meeting had ended, and at that point Sylphie and her people were going to get their homeland back at any cost. Looking at them, Kosuke now knows that everything's set in stone now, and now they have to claim the Omit Wilderness before the Holy Kingdom takes action, so this'll be race against time now. 3 days later, Sylphie got 50 people and they headed to the Omit Wilderness. Some days later they reached the first base, and then for the next 3 days, Kosuke was tasked to expand the farms they had. After that, the six of them set off to scout further into the Omit Wilderness. Half a day later, Kosuke finally found a good place for a camp. They didn't have much time until the sunset, so Sylphie told her to get back to work already. He quickly dug out an area and made the walls around. His friends were shocked to see him work that fast. Well, Eira was kind of used to it already, so her reaction was calm. And after placing some more things, Kosuke was finally done with the entire base. It was incredibly quick. Kyubi tells him that he'd have shattered any pride a craftsman would have. He smiles and says, "Well, it's pretty amazing, isn't it?" Eira then notices a weird tower above a building. Kosuke tells them that it's a water tower which provides water into the building. He also made a bathhouses to everyone's surprise. Later in the bathroom, Kosuke was taking a bath while praising himself for getting the plumbing done. Kyubi too was amazed cause he never thought he'd be able to bathe in middle of nowhere. On the other side, Sylphie and Sumo were taking a bath in delight, cause they never thought they could use this much water in the middle of nowhere. It's like a dream. Pilna and Eira too were glad, and thanked Kosuke for such a great gift. Suddenly someone calls for Kosuke. It was a wet furry dog. At first he didn't recognize him, but then realized it was Kyubi. Well, everyone says this when they see him like this, so it wasn't his fault. Kosuke then offered to wash his back, to which Kyubi happily agreed. A bit of skinship ain't that bad from time to time, Kosuke thinks that as the moon shines in the sky. After several days of exploring, they finally found a good place to build their main base. And according to Kosuke, this place had a good vantage point, since they can see the previous bases from here. But Sylphie felt like something was wrong here. Then Eira got the idea and started casting a magic spell. A sphere forms at the tip of her staff and Kosuke asked her what it was. It's an exploration spell that reacts to magical disturbances. And suddenly the sphere detects magic from underground, and it was from an old type of spell that warred against demons. There also was a campfire. Then Sumo remembered that one night, when they were fleeing to the Black Forest, the Gizmas didn't attack them, and that happened around this place. Kyubi and Pilna too remembers that happening. But Eira didn't remember what Sumo was talking about. Well, she was unconscious after using too much magic, so she wouldn't remember. But Sylphie didn't get why would there be something like that here. Eira told her, this thing harnessed magic from the earth vein that went out of use about 300 years ago, and she's surprised that it's still working. It's an ancient barrier device that has been here for too long. If it breaks, then it could accidentally start attracting the monster hordes. Hearing this, Sylphie wanted to take control of it. She asks Eira to tell her the exact location, and Eira showed them where they needed to go. The magic sphere stopped moving suddenly and points below. Kosuke then brings out his shovel and started digging down. He got there quickly and after some time he found something interesting. Kosuke seems to have hit a rock wall. Hearing this, the others decided to come down. He first made a room for them to stand and started digging more. When Kosuke dug the ceiling wall, they saw a really old underground ruin. There was a shiny item which was the barrier device, which were causing those waves. By looking at the decorations, Eira confirms that this place looked like a facility related to court mages, but she felt uncomfortable with those statues that were standing beside the device. It was obviously a golem's, kept there to protect the artifact from strangers. Kosuke was amazed. He had never seen golems before. He was very interested in how they operate. Eira told him that every golem has its core inside his body which allows them to move. If he destroys that, then it will stop. Kosuke then asks, how do they sense intrusion? Well, like humans, golems perceive things by sight. Hearing Kosuke realized he might be able to work things out, but first he need to get closer to them. Kosuke started doing his thing, while the other looks at him with anticipation. He was done blocking their limbs and eyes with the blocks, like a true craft player. Then he took his pickaxe and started to break their armor. After a few hits it cracked, and he could see the golem's core. That's unfair, Era sighs while others are dumbfounded. Everyone gathers near the barrier device while discussing about Kosuke's fighting method. Well, his way of fighting isn't exactly head-on, but that's a good thing because he gets the results he desires without hurting himself. And well, they got what they wanted, which can be useful in the future. Now Kosuke wanted to explore this place beyond the doors. But first they need to get back outside since Kosuke had to build a place for them to stay tonight. They get back up to meet the chirpy Pilna. While waiting for them, Kosuke made a base quickly, and they got their dinner at the end of the day. But he still had some more work to do in his forge. Kosuke then started smelting the materials for tomorrow's building project. Well, he needs that because he will be building a base for 3,000 people, which is quite a lot. He couldn't wait for it. However, he was a human, and he had been feeling a little tired lately. No, more precisely, he was frustrated. Little Kosuke has been rising to get some action, since he hasn't been with Sylphie in over 10 days, and that's a lot to take in. He can't spend the night with Sylphie because the women's have been sleeping together. Suddenly Sylphie appeared right from behind. It was so unexpected that he got scared. She was pretty surprised by his excited reaction. He asked her, "What brings you here this late?" Well, she got lonely, but what about him? He understood her hint. It seemed that they thought in the same way. But it's sad that they had no time for it. She gets close to him and tells him, "Isn't it a little late to worry about that?" Right now, she didn't care if someone would watch them. It was going to be a steamy night. And guess what? They bonked. As you know, this part is quite erotic. So for my cultured viewers, you can check it out on chapter 24. And as it usually happens, there were some spectators, and some were enjoying the view. Well, it would be better to just leave them alone. So they walked away to sleep. At the kingdom of the Melinard royal capital, the archbishop was enjoying some action, while the messenger was relaying the info about the war. He was hoping for the Black Forest operation to go well, since then he will get a large amount of breeding stock. And once he does that, the cardinal position will be his. The messenger informs him that the area around the Omit wilderness has been attacked by Gizmas, so the village surely would have been destroyed. But he didn't care about it for now, since he had some business to take care of. A week after the construction, 100 citizens and a group of significant figures arrive. Kosuke, who was dying from fatigue, was held by Sir Leonard and Miss Samaru. His powers were being exploited by his friends every day, and once he saw Melty's base plan, he realized it would be better to just drop everything and run away. But who said he can run away? He was caught by Sir Leonard and Miss Samaru in mere seconds. He had no choice from the beginning. Instead of making a simple barracks, Meldy wanted him to make houses for normal families, the one that can contain between 4 to 6 families. Kosuke told her, building for 3,000 people wasn't a joke. Well, there's no need to rush. Just work for exactly 8 hours every day like everyone else, and they would finish it quickly. Meldy even promised to give break on weekends. Kosuke thought about it for a while. Even if she was a cruel exploiter, she never lied to him. Now Kosuke wanted to know what kind of reward they were going to give him for his work. And Melty tells him that Princess would never let him work without a reward. Well, it was pretty obvious that she hadn't planned on giving him any kind of reward. Sylphie said they rely on his powers a lot, so she was ready to do anything she can. And she'll give anything she can give. Hearing this, Kosuke got a nasty idea. "You said anything, right?" "Anything." Kosuke gave her a smug smile, making Sylphie blush. Melty tells him, of course she wouldn't refuse. After all, it's a princess' duty to give appropriate reward to the worker. And Kosuke wonders what reward he would ask. The others realize that this was Melty's scheme to set them up. Looking at Sylphie, Kosuke wonders about the things that he will make Sylphie do. She just smirked instead of making any excuses. That's going to be interesting. Then Sylphie calls for Melty and asked if she had prepared herself. Well, of course, after all she is her faithful vassal. Kosuke didn't understand what was going on. He asked Danan, was it fine to talk like that as a vassal? Well, Melty wasn't actually a vassal, she is Sylphie's childhood friend. Melty's mother was Sylphie's milk mother, so basically a nanny. They have been raised like sisters, and they often talk to each other like that. Kosuke was surprised to hear that. He never heard Sylphie talk about that. Danan told Kosuke that she had a lot going on, so please keep supporting her. But well, it was time to go work hard. Melty grabbed Kosuke and they headed to the fields. Well, it's time for some exploitation. After all, they found out, if Kosuke plows and sows the field, then it will harvest within 3 days. And if he just plows and they plant the seed, it takes 2 weeks to harvest. So if Kosuke doesn't do anything, even the buds won't sprout. Danin and Sylphie watch them walking out then. He tells her that he haven't seen Aero around here. Sylphie tells her that she's probably in the underground ruins to study them. Aero there made up a little laboratory and was doing a lot of research to find a way to harness magic from the earth veins. Then Sylphie gathered everyone. There was an important news that she wanted to tell the newcomers. She first welcomed everyone, then tells them that this place will become a very important base for them. At first it's going to be a grueling task, but they must handle for the sake of making this land habitable. The people's morale rose up after Her Majesty's speech. Then 2 weeks later they got some results of their hard work. The city was complete and looked beautiful, but it was only the first step of their huge plan. Now it was time to start the main operation. With the recent upgrade, Kosuke unlocked a new skill. Now he could save a building's blueprint. So it meant he can build a registered structure in a single action, just like the world edit mod from a certain crafting game. But he still needed the same amount of resources. Anyway, the building speed was just impossible to comprehend. He had already built 2 buildings in quick succession, much to everyone's surprise. And a few minutes later he had already built the entire city. Now it was time for lunch. His comrades were praising him for his abilities. Now they had more time to get their other works done. Kosuke also installed 116 ballistas along the top of the walls. He also need to dig up a moat and set up Mr. Wood spikes around the walls and install a drawbridge. Kosuke also planned to place TNT under the base to blow it up in case they would need to retreat. Hearing this, both Sylphie and Aero were a bit concerned. Then Sylphie asked Danin about the liberation unit. Danin said there's our 6 units consisting of 12 soldiers, which should be enough for their mission. Danin had already started planning how they would sneakily enter the kingdom. They also have a map of it, but it's quite hard to plan their way since their map was old. Sylphie was expecting great result from this unit, since Kosuke did a giant part of his job. And with his power they had already built the frontline base, so this time it will be their turn to wreak havoc. Sylphie declared that in a few days the liberation units will be deployed, so don't neglect your training and preparation. And everyone was glad to hear that. Later at night, a monkey alchemist named Sykes was shook due to what happened with him today. He was scared of how someone dragged him into a dark alley. Thankfully, he was saved by Kosuke and Kyubi. Sir Leonard tells him it will be better for him to not take a walk outside alone at night. Then a fox man tells them that he too feels danger once in a while. Well, everyone here goes into heat sometimes after all. Blue Oni Indy, pretext. Well, no one here was glad about the fact the girls here were hunting them like that. Kosuke was wondering if everyone here got asked out, to which everyone just evaded the question embarrassingly. Kosuke now knew everyone did get approached by ladies after all. But why wasn't he ever asked out? Indy tells him, well, that was because the princess has her leash on him. Did he just compare him to a pet? While looking at Kosuka's situation, I don't think it's that far from the truth. Then Kosuke finds out that not only princess, but the other girls too had their eyes on him. Everyone knew that, so no one thought to tell him. But this was Kosuka's first time that he heard of that. Well, every MC has a trope of being dense, so there was no surprise. Kosuke couldn't believe it was possible, but now that he thinks about it, he remembers seeing that in the achievements. But none of the girls have shown their interest even when Sylphie wasn't around. Then Sir Leonard tells him that he have heard the girls discuss about this a lot, so he should just accept the fate when the time comes. But Kosuke was little distraught. Are they fine with the relation between a slave like him and Sylphie? Well, Kosuke was the reason that they can sustain themselves. Besides, the elders of the Black Forest have already acknowledged him as the legendary Marabito, so there's no problem. And besides, Sir Leonard said they have a shortage of men, so if they don't infiltrate the kingdom and take some men, then Sykes' chastity will be at risk. Well, bro is suffering from the problem that every man want to suffer with. Then Kosuke suggested him to just accept it. It was possible, but even so they lack in number. And if it comes to that, will Kosuke be accepting Aira and the others? Well, Kosuke was just fine with Sylphie, but deep down as a man he'd be lying if he said no to a harem. Sir Leonard tells him that being loyal is fine thing, but accepting the women one deemed worthy also shows a man's worth. But what about Sir Leonard? Well, he had actually offered himself to his late wife, so no. Then Sykes tells him that it's not good to have double standards. With an oblivious expression, Sir Leonard asked Kosuke about the construction of the underground shelter. The changing of the topic sounded a bit forced, but anyway, the construction and storage of the food, water, and ammunition were done. It was completed sooner than expected, so it seems they were going for the expedition maybe within a few days. By the way, Kosuke made a new food that they could take in their expedition. He then placed the cookies on the table. Everyone took a bite. It had a taste of dry fruits and nuts, and they can't get enough of that crumbly texture, and Kosuke was pleased to see them enjoy. Suddenly, someone knocked on the door. It was Eira. She was done with the design of the magic stone engine. It was exciting, but Kosuke wasn't sure if it can be registered into the blueprint function. Then Eira grabbed his hand and told him to come. Kosuke then remembered Sir Leonard's words. Bro was blushing harder than when Komi-san had to speak. Well, everyone seems to have a good vibe about them. Kosuke thought that there's no need for her to pull this hard since he would follow nevertheless. Is this what they call a female's advances? Well, it can't be helped, so he will enjoy this relationship for now. The next day was the day of the expedition. Sylphie wished them luck on their mission. Finally, the scout squads were going to save their people. Soon they left the fort to embark on their journey. Kosuke wanted to go with them. Well, with his abilities, it could certainly change the tides of the war. However, his abilities are only to be used in special cases. For now, they want to gain experience from this operation. Well, that was reasonable. Sylphie claims that this operation is doable even without his help, so she will make him do something only he can do. But more than that, he is important to them. Even so, his safety is in higher priority than her own, so no matter how much he wants to go, she won't let him go to the front lines. Eira tells him that Scout Unit is well equipped with the tools made by Kosuke, so he should believe in them and the tools that he made. Pilna chimed in as well, telling him that protecting everyone's home is Kosuka's job. Hearing this, Kosuke now knew that he was loved here. Relieved, he went to the workshop to do some crafting. As he and Eira enters, they saw skis buried between quite a large badonkers. Well, the mangaka has done a quite good job at drawing them. Later, the Lamia girls showed Kosuke the lever-action crossbow they made inspired by his design. He was shocked to see that they made it so quick. It was nicely made and he was eager to try it out. He pulled the lever backward to load the arrow and shot it. Seeing it in action, Kosuke knew that with this design the rate of fire will increase significantly. He then felt the Lamia girl tail around his leg, and the touch of her badonkers freaks him out. Sadly, her horny plan failed and Kosuke was on high alert. Then he suggested to apply golem mechanisms to this. Unfortunately, it couldn't be possible since this was too small. But adding it to a ballista won't be a problem at all. However, the more important thing was how to build a golem, and how hard it would be. Eira said if it's just made to pull the string, then it won't be that hard to make. Kosuke wondered how would they create a golem core. Well, Sykes already had an idea about how to make it. Hearing this, Kosuke realized if Sykes made that, then he can register it with his ability and craft it. While they were talking about that, the others were already contemplating about how to make the automatic ballista. Eira complimented Kosuke because his perspective were very different from them. Then Sykes suggested about allowing the user to provide magic to it. Kosuke was perplexed. Then Eira tells him if they add this, then the energy consumption would be very low, and Kosuke was fine with that. With this, they were all enthusiastic about this project. 5 days later, everything was ready. They were testing out their upgraded version of ballista. It was working great. Sylphie saw it and praised everyone who was working with Kosuke on this project. Getting this compliment from their princess, it raised everyone's mood. Then they saw Pilna coming back with some great news. Jajira's squad was coming back along with 37 liberated people, and they are expected to arrive at the base the day after tomorrow. With an epic dab, Kosuke was ready wearing his white coat. Confused, Eira asks, why the white coat though? Well, let's get prepared first, since the injured people have already arrived. The first guy arrives with his fractured arm. While Kosuke was prepping his medicine, he turns to greet the patient. And as he looks at him, everyone was shocked to see a human here. Eira and Meldy were trying to calm the people, but the outbreak was very harsh against Kosuke. On the other hand, Sylphie asked Jajira's group, what about the injured? Well, all the members of the 5th unit were unharmed. If it's like that, then let's go ahead with the report. Jajira informs that the infiltration was quite challenging, as they expected their guard was up, since they were attacked by the Gizma. And according to their plan, 2 units infiltrated through the forest in the cover of darkness. Danan then asks, what about the village's situation? Well, the situation was far from what they expected. The villages have been maintaining their way of living even before they became a vassal state. and it seems the goal of the Holy Kingdom was to suppress the mines that produce high-quality rock, salt, and iron. The villagers were used to mines, so they can't let them starve, and if they impose some outrageous law, the Holy Kingdom's international position might be put at risk. But even with that, heavy taxes were imposed, and they had their freedom of movement restricted by armed soldiers. And if anyone showed defiance, their family and friends were severely punished, resulting in a small child death. Hearing this, both Sylphie and Danan seems agitated. The Holy Kingdom also forced them to convert to a different teaching. While they did get rid of the soldiers and made it look like the work of bandits, then they freed the villagers as a sign of goodwill. Later, Sir Leonard went deeper into the kingdom to join and help with the operation on their side. The villagers they freed know very little of the situation inside the urban area, so that's all they had for report. Sylphie understood and asks if they had any complaints or suggestion to improve the equipments. They look at each other and think about it. Later, looking at Kosuke, Sylphie wonders, what was he doing? Kosuke was surrounded by the refugees' kids. It seems that they were quite fond of him. Well, it seems like that now, but the situation was extremely chaotic at first. The liberated people were very angry at seeing a human here, and refused to receive treatment even when Melty and Aira persuaded. But after treating the first person, they finally started believing. He tells Sylphie to inform them about him beforehand starting next time. Sylphie seems to get that they really had it rough. Kosuke then asks about the report. She will tell him about this later, because there are two requests from the troops, so now it's time for Kosuke and workshop members to shine. At the workshop, Sylphie tells them about the request. First is a warm meal that they can eat without starting fire, and second is a tool for communicating with allies who are far apart. They all think about this. Food's quality could drastically improve morale, and communication are vital for war, but this seems difficult. Sykes tells them that hot meals aside, communications are quite a difficult problem. Then they decided to deal with the problem one by one, so let's start with warm meals first. After thinking for a while, they decided to make a small portable heater, and Lamia girl suggested to make it a multi-purpose pot that can also be used as a shield. Then Sykes asks how strong should he make the heater? Well, it was fine as long as either the user or a magic stone could supply it with magic. Aira then asks Kosuke if there's a way to solve this using his knowledge. After thinking about it, he remembers a method that used quicklime to react with water to heat up the food, basically a MRE. But still, these are disposable items that needs to be thrown away after a single use, so wouldn't it be difficult to make in large quantities? Aira wasn't sure about it, but it isn't bad to continue research in multiple areas. Then the next problem is communication. Kosuke suggested using Morse code. It's a method of communication using a cipher based on the length of a signal. And just like the device back at the head base, it would release a wave of magic and one would communicate with that wavelength. Well, it would have been easier if one could relay voices using that wave, but that's another matter. Everyone there seems to be interested in the use of wavelength. Then Aira confirms that it's possible to do it using golem technology, and they will work alongside to create the cipher. Kosuke was impressed. So now it's time to get to work. The next day, all the liberated people left for the head base. After bidding them adieu, Kosuke hopes nothing happens to them on the way to the main base. Well, armed guards were assigned, so they should be fine. But Kosuka's main worry was that all the men moved to the main base, so it seems that Sykes' suffering will continue. Sylphie was a bit confused by that. Later at the office, Kosuke tells her all about the issue. Sylphie seems to recognize it as a big problem, but that smile doesn't help in this matter. Kosuke tells her that it's a big deal since the men were in trouble. Sylphie calls him and asks if any women other than her has piqued his interest. Kosuke was momentarily stunned by this question. Well, everyone was cute and pretty, so he'd be lying if he said he wasn't interested. But he never had a thought of getting involved with anyone but her. Hearing this, Sylphie was blushing red. She shyly tells Kosuke that she isn't ladylike, nor is she cute. Shocked, Kosuke gets up from his seat. It seems that she's unaware of her cuteness, so with an intense look, now he wants to dress her up with the ultimate clothes. Shocked, Sylphie tries to stop him, but Kosuke wasn't the one to stop. He strips her down. And after a while, she was standing in a frilly dress all propped up. Kosuke wanted to show her to everyone, but there's no way she was gonna do that. Kosuke calls for Melty, and when she sees Sylphie, her inner demon seems to have come out. Sylphie makes a run for it, and Melty follows soon after. A while later, Sylphie had locked herself in a room. She wasn't going to open the door on anyone's request, but Melty had a great idea. She instructs Kosuke to make a lot of costumes so when she and the others puts it on, Sylphie will get jealous and come out by herself. Kosuke wonders, won't she sulk more instead? Well, there's no way she can be wrong, since she has been with her for a long time. But looking at Melty's creepy smile, Kosuke realizes she just wants to wear it herself. Sometimes later, group of women were waiting in a queue, and some were changing on the other side. There Kosuke was crafting clothes for them, he hands one out, and she goes to change. Melty and Aira comes out in their new outfit. Melty was happy, but we can't say the same for Aira. Kosuke compliments that it suits her, but she wanted something else. Kosuke looks through his collections and gives her something new to wear. Everyone else were wearing their cute attire, and some others had a certain charm to it. I think Kosuke agrees on that. Melty gets close and tells him to look through the window, and when he turns to look, there Sylphie was peeking through the window in anger and jealousy. Melty, with a seductive charm, asks if she could change into a sexier outfit. Well, those are for Sylphie, so no. But hearing Melty click her tongue, he hands her a new outfit to try. By then Aira and the Harpies were in their new clothes, and Kosuke was loving them all. Melty comes out in her clothes and approaches Kosuke, and by the looks of it he doesn't mind that bombastic view. Sylphie finally comes out in her dress. Kosuke and Melty gangs up on her to try something new, but she refuses. Well, everyone was wearing clothes from another world, so there's nothing to be worried about. Sylphie finally realizes that they planned it, but it was too late to decline. She was caught in their trap. Melty drags her into the changing room against her cries, and looking at it, Kosuke realizes, as expected, Melty was the strongest. Suddenly someone asks about the ruckus. When they look back, there stands Danin. He scolded them for doing this when the liberation units were deployed. Cheerful Melty comes out and brings out Sylphie in her new clothes, which were rather too risque. Well, no one seems to mind though. Even the princess, Danin exclaims. She tries to deny it, but her clothes states otherwise. A while later, all three of them were kneeling in the office. Danin was angry, but this raised their morale, so he can't really scold them. Suddenly there was a knock on the door. It was Aira. She tells them that Pilna has returned with an urgent report. Outside, Pilna was cutely sipping on a cup of water. Sylphie rushes out and asks for the report. The 1st, 2nd and 6th units attack on salt mine was a success. Around 800 people were liberated from the salt mines, and now they are making their way through the Omit wilderness, but they don't have enough food, water and other provisions. Hearing the news, they were astonished, but the amount of refugees seems a lot for Kosuke, and Sylphie wonders what could be their next plan. Pilna further tells them that the scout group would liberate villages between the salt mines and the wilderness while making their way back here, and they are expected to arrive at the nearest shelter in 1 week. It seems the number of refugees are still growing. Sylphie thinks about it for a while, then she orders them to start retrieving supplies from the main base and let Kosuke carry it. Meanwhile, Melty will sort the supplies that she can send out. And with that, the plan was almost ready. She then tells Danin to send a message to Zamel at main base, and Pilna will relay this to the liberation unit. This time she, Kosuke and 5 other harpies will mobilize. It's time to prepare, since they will depart tomorrow morning before sunrise. Guys, after editing this chapter, I found out that there are 2 more chapters for this manga, and being a lazy sob, I can't include that now. So tell me in the comments if you would like a short recap video, or should I wait out for next chapters? Can we sign a petition so Melty can get more screen time, please?